What's up, guys? Welcome to a new Poker Life podcast. We're live. We're here. I'm in Germany right now. I'm in a whatever, man. I'm in an interesting place. Today we're joined by a guy who's I haven't played Nolan Hold'em for 4 or 5 years. And there's this guy on Runitonce making videos, screen name Gogol's Nose. I'm like, you know, I remember that name from back in the, there's a lot of bees around here, from back in the day. So I started watching his videos. I'm like, all right, I'm going to go to sleep, watch this video. First video of his I watched on Runitonce, I was like, this guy's awesome. He's like, this is a fold. This is a call. He sounded so sure when he said it. I started referring, like when I was walking around, people were asking me what to do. I'm like, we're doing this. We're doing that. It's like, it was my Gogol's Nose approach to life. It's where you say something with confidence and that's it. And I started watching this video. I didn't go to sleep to the video. I had to put on Phil Galfond video, go to sleep. Shout out to Phil Galfond. He puts me to bed a lot. And then I just kept watching his videos. And now he's one of my favorite video producers. I've been wanting to have him on. This was the longest intro I've ever done in my life. Welcome to the podcast, Tyler Forrester, a.k.a. Gogol's Nose. What's up, puppy?
Well, thanks, Joey. That was a heck of an intro. I really appreciate that. I'm glad I didn't put you to sleep. Galfond's voice is super soothing, by the way.
Yeah,
I find it really relaxing to listen to him.
I got to make sure it's running right. All right, we look good. All right, cool. Yeah, so whenever I listen to Phil's videos, I mean, I also think it's because we've probably been listening to Phil's videos for years now. So whenever you listen to his, it really is pretty soothing.
He is. He's got a great radio voice.
He does, man. All right, well, let's just get into this, man. So I've been on a little podcast hiatus. I did a couple when I was live in Vegas. I haven't really done too many the past 2 months. And I'm really excited that you decided to join me for my first one back here. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. You don't do many podcast interviews, anything like this, right?
No, this is my first one, Joey. So you'll have to forgive me if I swear a lot or do something.
No. So here's what you are allowed to do on here. You're allowed to drink. We got our whiskey and our Coke right here. Shout out to Anski for putting us onto this one.
Excellent.
You're allowed to swear. You're allowed to talk about anything you'd like to talk about, man. So don't hold back. We try to be GTO around here, but you can sometimes deviate from GTO. I know that you're very GTO orientated on your approach to poker, but I'm not quite sure if that carries over to your own life as well.
Sometimes.
All right. So Tyler, let's tell people a little bit about you. Here's what I know about you. If someone before I did the podcast with you today said, who is this guy you're having on? You've been playing Pokerstars for forever, it seems like. You were at the Midstakes games when I was still playing 50 cent dollar back in 2007 or something like that, 2008. You've been playing the Midstakes. I'm pretty sure before you were one of the biggest winners. I think now you still could be one of the biggest winners somehow after years and years and years. And that's pretty much what I would how I would describe you. Is that accurate? What else would I add if you were going to give someone the 30-second
I've been playing Midstakes on Stars for years. I've made a decent amount of money doing it. I started playing poker in 2004. I was playing the party 5-10 games in 2005. I played those until UIEGEA.
UIEGEA, yeah, I think that's right. Okay.
Acronym that is impossible to pronounce. And then I switched to Stars, and I've played Midstakes or higher on it for the last 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah.
So you're like, so back in the day when I always saw those guys, I'm like, these idiots, why don't they ever move up? They never move up. They just stay there. And they're like, what's happened with them? You're one of those guys, except now 10 years later, here you are, probably make some decent money over those past 10 years playing the Midstakes games and Stars, huh?
Yeah. I mean, it was a good living, and I liked the risk profile of it. And, you know, I never had to go off a lot of money to make decent cash, so. It fit my lifestyle a little bit better than playing high stakes poker. My hands always got really shaky when I bet $4,000 or $5,000 on a hand.
Yeah, I know how that. You're like kind of like this. Your heart's beating real fast. The first couple times it happens, your heart's beating fast. It's pumping out of your chest. But then after a while, you're like, I'm a degenerate. I need to stop doing this. So it's kind of what happened.
Yeah, I have to actually save some of this money I'm making as opposed to giving it to the best players in the world.
Would you say you're one of the better players in the world? But you kind of have to be. If you're beating Midstakes for 10 years, and I believe your win rate is still pretty good, you almost have to be one of the best players in the world. If I feel like if you can win in those games, like, those are some of the hardest games to win in.
Well, that's super flattering. I never thought I was one of the best in the world. I just showed up to work every day and worked hard at it. Hopefully things went my way, and, you know, they've been pretty good to me. I can't complain.
So you're from the United States. I don't Google anyone, but I was like, I just want to Google just in case. I'm trying to be a little bit more informed previous to going into podcasts. Because normally I just like, I write things down. I just wing it. I don't even need to look at the things I write down. I just start talking and look at the comments and start learning. But I did Google you. You're from America. You went to the University of Duke. Shout out to Duke, by the way. Shout out to Pratush. Are you friends with Pratush? Do you know Pratush's?
I don't know Pratush. I'll have to meet him.
He's a fellow Duke Blue Devil, I believe. I feel like you guys are probably similar people when it comes to a lot of what you think about poker. But I don't know about. Do you like well, you're married, right?
Yes, I'm married.
Okay, never mind. You might not be like Pratush in some other ways then. I call his nickname's PLP. So it's Pussy Lemon Pratush. Shout out to him, by the way, man. We're gonna get him back on a podcast. Sometime soon. So you might not have that in common. So you're American. You went to Duke. You ended up moving out of the country to Costa Rica. Shout out to Poker Refugees. Shout out to Kristen, who runs Poker Refugees. I met her in Vegas. I'm going to have her on a podcast. She seemed like a awesome, awesome person.
Yeah, she's a great person.
Did you, when you decided to move out of the country, was it like an instant decision? You're like, all right, got to go? Or what was the process like for you?
Well, I was a little shocked, I think, like everybody else. I'm sure you were sitting at your computer going, what the heck just happened? And yeah.
Go ahead.
You know, this little thing pops up on your screen and says you can't play anymore. And you're going, why? Why can't I play? As soon as that happened, though, I mean, I just took stock of my options. I had some land. I had a house. And I had mortgage payments to make. So the logical conclusion was it was time to leave the country. So, about 6 weeks later, I was in Canada, and then the next year I spent in Costa Rica.
So when you moved, were you married at the time?
I wasn't married at the time.
So you had a house, you had land. Did you sell that, or did you start renting that out? What did you do about that?
You know, I put it on the market, and I tried to sell it because obviously you can't live in it, so what's the best option? Time to sell. So I put that on the market and took off to Canada and rented a cheap place and, you know, grinded for several months, 6 months, pretty hard. And, I mean, the housing market was pretty slow, so it took it basically a year, year and a half to sell it. By that point, I was out of Costa Rica, and then I decided I just liked playing poker and traveling, so that's what I did for the next couple of years. I'm finally back in the U.S. again, which I'm super happy about.
Are you not super happy about it?
No, I'm totally super happy about it.
Do you feel like you missed the United States? You missed English? You missed – shout out to English. Shout out to people – shout out to people that speak English, because I haven't had an actual conversation with someone who can understand everything I was saying, and I debatably say some things that aren't understandable by people who are actually speak English. But I haven't had a conversation with someone who understood all my English in weeks. So shout out to anyone that speaks English out there. You guys are playing really great. But okay, so you feel you missed the United States. You're happy to be back. What did you miss about being home?
It's just nice to be in a spot where you know you're going to be there for the next year or 2 years. You're not having to worry about your next location to grind out a living, basically. And I like being close to my family. I mean, I'm a family guy. My nickname's not PLP. So it's nice to be back to the back to my folks and my brother and all those people that I care about.
Let's think about this. Hold on a second. FMF, Family Man Forrester?
Yeah, that'd probably be better. I don't know if that's catchy enough though.
Family Man Forrester. I don't know. I told a friend of mine you were coming on the podcast, and she was like, I like his name. I was like, he's got a strong name. I'm like, yeah, he does have a strong name. You're right. Tyler Forrester. It's a very strong name.
Well, thank you. I'm glad that she liked my name.
Shout out to her, by the way. She's not here. Shout out to the stalkers. The stalkers are watching. You have too many stalkers when you were living abroad? You have people who like checked on you constantly, what you were doing on Facebook or anything like that?
No, not particularly. At least I don't think so. They never got caught if they were stalking me.
Yeah, some I feel like these stalkers are pretty they're pretty sly about their operations.
Well, you've got a prettier face than I do, Joey, so not surprised you've got more stalkers.
I mean, you're also married, though. How long have you been married for?
A year and a half now.
Hmm. So did you I'm confused. So how did this work? Were you dating when you were living abroad? Were you single? Were you married?
We were dating while I was living abroad. She was going to school, and so we did the long-distance thing for a couple of years. It's a good story. We were high school prom dates, so we've known each other for a long time.
Okay. Tell me more. What happened here? How did it go from high school prom date to married? Now you're at home in the USA with her.
We ran into each other after college, and we were both living back in Dillon, Montana, my hometown. And we started dating, and then I had to move abroad for the once Black Friday happened, and we kept dating, and she was really, really sweet about it, and we kept together, and several years later, we're now married very happily.
So do you think that being in that long-distance relationship while living in some place like Costa Rica from the poker friends I know, it has a selection of women around there that could potentially – get into your mind and maybe distract you? Do you feel like having this long-distance relationship was overall good for your focus and your ability to work hard, to grind, to put in hours, and to continue to have success playing?
Yeah, I mean, I think it kept me on even keel because when you're traveling a lot, I mean, it's a fairly quiet lifestyle. You're moving from town to town, so it was nice to have a very consistent, know you always had a phone call that night, someone who cared about you and loved you and wanted to talk to you. I found it, super nice. That was amazing for that period of time.
Did you have a lot of friends in different places? So you moved to Canada, you moved to Costa Rica. Did you have a lot of people you hung out with there? Did you keep to yourself?
In Canada, I basically just hopped up there by myself. I just said, I have to go. And so I drove across the border and said, I'm playing poker up here. And I eventually met some folks, but the first couple of months, it was pretty slow. You got a job to do, and that's what you're doing. In Costa Rica, I had a much bigger social network. With Kristen around, I mean, there's just so many poker players in Costa Rica. There must have been a couple hundred guys while I was down there, and I met a vast majority of them. So that was a little more social of an activity than grinding in Canada.
So when did you leave Costa Rica? What year was that?
2012, in December.
2012. So what have you been doing in these past 3 years? You said you obviously love to travel. We talked before we came on. You mentioned you were in London, and there's a story you might want to tell from there. So what did you do after that point in time?
So I went back to school for a while. I was contemplating doing something else. So I spent a semester in school, and then I went to Fernie, Canada, which is a beautiful resort town up in the Rocky Mountains up in British Columbia. And I lived with a couple of poker players, and it was a great time. And then I got married, and then we lived 6 months in Rosarito, and then we spent a year up in Fernie in Lethbridge, Alberta, after that. And we just got back to the U.S. June 25th.
Oh, shout out to my birthday, June 24th. Okay.
Nice. Happy belated birthday, Joey.
Yeah, don't remind me, man. I asked you before how old you were. You said you're 31 years old, correct?
Yeah, 31.
How does it feel to be 31? Because I'm going to be 31 next year, and I just want to prepare myself for it.
I it feels a lot like 30. I hate to break it to you, but they're about the same.
Okay, I'm not worried yet. You're as old as you feel. That's what they tell me, and I feel like most days I feel like I'm 21 years old. So
you're 21 years old, clearly.
Yeah, I'm gonna start telling people that. Okay, so your wife now, she's started traveling with you. She stayed with you in Rosarita.
She stayed with me in Rosarito and in Fernie and Lethbridge.
Cool. So how was that for her? I think I know a lot of women that I've met. They enjoy being productive. They enjoy working on something. They enjoy having their own sort of thing. And when you're living in Rosarita, there's really not much for an American woman, I feel like, to do down there besides try to avoid getting kidnapped by people. So
we were okay. We had the guards in front of the complex. I think she enjoyed the vacation aspect of it. It was really a 6-month-long honeymoon for us because we were right on a beach and we just got married. We had a little cute little bungalow. So it was a very extended honeymoon. At this point, I think she's ready to do something else. After a year or two of it, but I think she liked it. I mean, she enjoys traveling. She's in Europe this week, so she's having a great time over there.
What part of Europe is she in?
Hungary, in Vienna, Austria.
Hungary?
Hungary. Budapest.
What's she doing in Budapest?
She had some friends who were studying in Graz, Austria, so she flew over and saw them.
The hell? Yeah, that's awesome. That's pretty cool. You said she sounds like she's ready to get to something. What do you think that means for the future of your own poker playing?
I think that we're going to see me playing a lot less poker in the future. I'm pretty nearing retirement, if not this year, next.
Are you? I very much can relate to that feeling, by the way. But so you feel like your wife made a sacrifice for you for this period of time. Now it's sort of your turn to make a sacrifice, but at the same time, it's also an opportunity for you to do something else with yourself and focus on something else and pursue other passions or hobbies that you have.
Yeah, exactly. Everything's a trade-off. I wouldn't view it as a sacrifice. I'm interested in a lot of different things, and there's a lot of different avenues to pursue those things.
You know, it's funny. I always viewed it as like a sort of sacrifice type of thing, where if you're with somebody and you decide to, stay in the country, you're sort of sacrificing your ability to potentially maximize the amount of money you can make.
Maybe. There's a lot of different avenues to make money, and I don't know if poker is the best one at this point.
100% agree with you, by the way. 100% agree with you. What else are you thinking about getting into from this point in time?
I've got a couple of things I'm doing. I'm making videos now. I'm coaching, which I wouldn't classify as poker playing because I'm teaching people how to play poker as opposed to doing it myself. Mm-hmm. Sometimes those things don't necessarily combine very well. I have some rental properties that I run. I'm going back to school or possibly have a job in a tech field. I'm going to be going back to school for computer programming. Mm-hmm. So I'll become a computer programmer here.
So I've heard a lot about a lot of people. This is one of the biggest things people have been talking about for maybe the past couple months is the idea of rental properties, buying properties, renting them out, and making consistent money on them. Is that something you started doing? You started doing that probably a long time ago.
Yeah, I bought my first fourplex in 2007, so I've been doing it quite a while now, actually.
Wow. So is the idea for you to have a lot of properties and make a bunch of money off of those over time?
The basic idea was that the poker income was so unstable. You know this in your own career, that you can't really predict month to month how much money you're going to make. The legal situation is always such that it's literally in complete limbo and has been for the last 10 years. Yep. So whatever money you made playing poker, you couldn't really turn it into a cash flow. It was more like a lump sum payment. Just got a lump sum of money at this point in time, and then you had to figure out how to live off of it for a period of time. You didn't never was were sure when the next time you were going to get paid was. Mm-hmm. So the idea was is to use the rental properties to kind of level out the cash flow. So you had a monthly income coming in, even if poker wasn't going so well.
Passive income for the win, the JC Bella says. I agree. That's one thing I just from talking with people, man, passive income, something I very much neglected to think about. My prior years in my life. It sounds like you were sort of thinking about that for quite a long time now.
Yeah, I was always a little worried about the legal situation in the U.S. with poker. And then with the traveling, I mean, how long can you travel? Eventually you have to settle down somewhere. So it never seemed like long term that I was going to be able to, play poker for the next 40 years. Mm. And if that was true, I needed to figure out how to turn these lump sum payments into some sort of cash flow. Mm.
So do you have any other sort of ideas in mind for other ways you can do that? Or are you pretty focused on I'm going to school, becoming a computer programmer, and then doing that?
I think that's the way I'm going to go with it, but who knows? My mind changes occasionally. I have some freedom. The poker business has been pretty good to me. I've saved a lot of my money. So I'm not exactly against or between a rock and a hard place on this.
it seems like a lot of people are I'm myself included, into the idea of entrepreneurship, you know, working for yourself, having your own business, building something up that, you know, you can build to whatever it is, how high you want to build it to be able to make a living and work for yourself, work your own hours. Is that something that you've thought about doing or interested in doing?
I'm very interested in doing it. It's just trying to figure out the right avenue to do it in. That's the trick with it. I think the computer programming gives me a lot of options, especially in poker playing at this point in time. Being a computer programmer is going to become more and more essential to success.
What do you mean by that?
I think we're already seeing in the mid-stakes games that a lot of the better regs, they may not be being accused of being bots, but they're certainly using computer analysis to improve their play.
Are you think they're using this in real time, or do you think they're using this after the fact when they're analyzing and breaking down their sessions?
My guess, who knows? I mean, how do you establish this? I'm sure you've seen some of these GTO solutions in poker, Joey. I mean, they're like, do this 52% of the time and do that 43% of the time. It's not like you can run a test program to prove that they're doing it at those frequencies. You'd have to have access to all their hands and then the solution to the problem. Mm-hmm. So I have no idea when they're doing it, but it's very obvious that they are doing it in some form or another.
So my question is this for you. Obviously, the PLO botting situation on PokerStars, they're on iPoker, they're on all the sites, I'm pretty positive. If they're beating PLO, if they're the biggest winners at 1-2 and 2-5 and 2-4 at PLO, how can there not be bots at No Limit Hold'em in those games that you've been playing in, day out?
That's a really good question. I think one would have to assume there probably are bots. They just happen to maybe not be as advanced, or maybe we're just seeing a lot of the big winners. I mean, a lot of the big winners are already utilizing software to help them. Mm-hmm. It may not be in-game, but they're certainly using it to review their hands, to model the situations. And you're going to see more and more of that as this gets farther along. I think you've seen this in a couple of players this year that, you know, come out of nowhere and all of a sudden grind a million hands a year. Really decent win rates. And you'd have to suspect that they're using some sort of computer software to help them along, whether they're doing it in-game or post-game, I don't know. But it's hard to believe you can get that much experience with playing zero hands of poker.
Really? You think so, huh?
Yes.
Well, you know, the internet poker these days, man, it's the wild motherfucking West out there. For those guys that don't, I mean, there's some crazy, there's a lot of weird shit happening out there, man. There's a lot of interesting things happening out there. And I guess that factors into your decision to sort of be happy about maybe having to retire from poker and pursue these other avenues.
You know, I think it provides better opportunities for me in the long run. I really enjoyed playing poker. I love playing poker, and I'll still love playing poker. But the Wild West of, you know, 2004, 2005 is... it's moved on.
Yeah, it's I guess the big talk now is with regulation in America, with California, and you know, that's sort of what people seem to be, a lot of American regulars I know seem to be hoping on that happens at some point in time. Is that something you're thinking about or even have in the near future for your own, I guess, thought process or thinking about it?
I mean, I'd like to be able to play poker from here in Montana. I think that'd be great. That being said, I don't think it will ever see the same sort of cash cow that it was in 2005 and 2006. I mean, there's some, you know, there's some pretty big differences in demographics. At least six max hold'em never existed before. Mm-hmm. No one knew how to play it in 2005. I mean, we really built it from the ground up. You're going, I don't know how to do this. No one knows how to do it. The only books were written about nine-handed hold'em. You know, no one had done the internet thing before. And the next time around, the markets are going to be much better developed. The sharks are just going to be a heck of a lot better than they were, you know, 10 years ago.
I think you see this with something like the Spin and Goes. So Spin and Goes, still fairly new on PokerStars. I mean, the websites I'm seeing for this, they got apps, they got stables. It's ridiculous. It's crazy. I mean, honestly, it's crazy. Like, when I see this shit, I'm like, it really makes, you know, I don't know. It makes me, it's wild. The sharks they realize I can't make money at poker anymore. I gotta start making money this way at poker. And I think you're only going to see it get worse and worse as time goes on.
So I think that it's just going to change. Different games will become popular. people will, you know, they'll just keep trying to find new methods of doing it. I think that maybe no limit hold'em won't be the game of choice in the future. I think you made a really smart call going to PLO as early as you did, because that game would be a heck of a lot harder to beat and solve from a, you know, GTO standpoint than no limit is.
No, I think that's exactly what I was thinking when I did it. I guess also I wanted to get Supernova Elite easier that year. So I'm like, all right, I did some calculations, which don't require much, you know, math ability. It's like, I'm getting this amount of VBP at 2-4 at no limit. I'm getting this amount of VBP per hand at 2-4 at PLO. I'm going to go play PLO. Like, I'm getting out of here. I'm done. And then also, obviously, at the same time, you know, people were saying, get into PLO now. Don't wait for it's too late. And I think I wish I did it 2 years earlier, but at the same time, I'm still happy that I did it at the time I did it in. So,
yeah, I mean, I think we've seen a lot of people win a lot of money at PLO over the last 3 or 4 years.
For sure.
Just glancing at the illicit, you know, winning sites. I mean, it looks like the PLO guys are making almost double of what the No Limit guys are at this point.
Wait, what did you just call it?
The illicit winnings.
The illicit winning site? I like that name. IWS, the illicit. I have another name. It's called Russian PTR. I think it caught on when I made it up with that name. But illicit winning site, actually, that's got a good ring to it.
I think your Russian PTR is out of the bag. I'm pretty sure that's what everyone calls it now, Joey.
Well, I know. I'm happy. Like, I like to make up terms, and then they block. Wait, hold on. Wait a second. Are you saying there's another site?
No, I'm not saying there's another site. I just wasn't going to give them free press on your program.
Oh, well, we don't actually say the name of the site. Shout out to them. I do. I have spoke with the owners of that site. I like those guys a lot. They always ask me why people ask them why it's Russian PTR, and they thanked me for helping them get some more exposure. Shout out to them, by the way. But yeah, we don't mention the site by name, though. We keep it on the DL, man. We keep it.
I'm not even sure if the site's named, in all honesty. I'm pretty sure it's just like, it's literally gibberish.
Nah. I mean, it is. Maybe we were thinking about different sites. But, you know, I guess when you think about the Midstakes games now, I guess, how would you say that you think they're tough? I mean, you seem to still be winning at a pretty good win rate. Do you think that you just work harder than other people when it comes to understanding the idea of GTO and the approach needed to win these games like it is right now?
There's two facets to this. I mean, one is understanding where the money comes from, and the second part's understanding how to beat regulars, and the combination of which will generate a really high win rate. I think we're going to see less of the scripting, bum hunting side of things. If we look at this year's, this year's biggest winners, we're seeing that most of the action switched to Zoom. So we're going to see most of the biggest winners now being actually probably true GTO players. I think the leather asses of the world they're basically doomed. Zoom is going to take over this pool. And I think we can see that just looking at win rates of players and things.
So what do you think is going to happen to the Midstakes games? And it's basically anyone who's playing from an exploitative standpoint just isn't going to win.
No, I actually think the exploitive play is going to matter quite a bit, and I think it will always matter quite a bit. You've seen the GTO solutions like I have. If you're choosing one action 52% of the time and one action 48% of the time, it obviously doesn't matter which action you're choosing. Mm-hmm. Either action's perfectly valid. So the actual money's being generated by picking the right action against that player, is understanding which action that you should prefer against a certain player. And you'll see that even in the Zoom pools. There's only 100 players. That's enough that you can get decent statistics on them. It's not so large that it's completely, you know, you're completely readless in these situations. Mm-hmm. So I think you actually see players who are better poker players making more money now, because you can't take a leather ass approach to playing poker. You really just can't bum hunt your way to millions. So you're going to be forced to learn how to play some sort of GTO style against players you don't know, and then exploit the players that you do know. And really think hard about how to exploit those players. And that's where the game will go. And I think the Zoom pools overall, I think they benefit Pokerstars a little bit, because the win rates will always be a little bit lower in them. But it looks like they're still pretty healthy, at least in No Limit. I can't speak for PLO.
Yeah. I think Yeah, I wonder. I feel like No Limit. I don't really follow the Six Max games too much, but how were they previous to the Zoom being introduced at 2.4 and at 3.6? Was it just a wild, wild west of scripting and?
No, it wasn't as bad because you had players who wanted to play poker. So they'd spend their time starting games and keeping games running. The games wouldn't automatically break because these players, you know, they were here to gamble. They wanted to play. They might be regs, but they weren't here just to make money off the fun players, mm-hmm. like to call them. So these games were much more consistently stable than they were once Zoom was introduced. Because once Zoom was introduced, you saw a transition where players who wanted to play poker, they'd play Zoom, and people who wanted to make money from fun players or at least guarantee a win rate would choose to play the cash games, mm-hmm. the non-Zoom games. Hmm. And so that really created a much more – I mean, it just made the tables harder to sustain because the people who were sustaining them were playing Zoom now.
They still have regular tables, right?
They definitely have regular tables.
Do they still run anymore? Do people play? I'm showing how out of touch I am with No Limit Hold'em. I haven't clicked on that tab in 3 years or something like that. I really haven't.
No, they still run. You'll just see the situation where three of the players will sit down at a table and wait for the recreational player. Or two of the players will sit and wait for a recreational player. The recreational player will join and, you know, scripters will come in and fill up the rest of the table within a millisecond or two.
The fucking seat scripts, man. God, I imagine at No Limit, they're out of control. I'm sure everyone has a script pretty much in No Limit Hold'em. You almost have to have a script at playing No Limit these days, I think.
Yeah, you really had two options. You either start the games or you have a script. Mm. Those are the best two options. And I'm not sure how viable the scripts are at this point in time because there's only two extra seats on the table or three. And those three seats are going to get filled up by people who are closest to the servers. So if you had a script and you were in Australia, it's probably not your best area. You're probably not going to have a lot of success with it.
Hear that, boys? If you got a script out there, move closer to Isle of Man. Or move closer. Well, if you live in, I guess, I was going to say there are servers in New York. So if you live near New York, you could, you know, that's getting into another can of worms for another time. You know, well, I guess in that situation, you're actually connected somewhere else. So whatever, fine. It's fine. Let's not talk about that. Is that, what do you think? Do you feel like at No Limit Hold'em these days, that's an issue? Is there a lot of multi-accounting going on? Is there a lot of, is that something to worry about? Is that something you think about? What's the status of that these days?
Multi-accounting. I don't think it affects the Midstakes games to the same extent that it affects the high-stakes games. Because the Midstakes games, you've always got a lot of players moving in and out of the pool, and the reads are never going to be as strong or as pertinent. It's really valuable to be a high-stakes player and know exactly how some other guy plays when you're playing for thousands and thousands of dollars. When you're playing for $400 and you might play 50 hands with them, it's not that valuable.
Yeah, I think at some point in time, even with the high stakes multi-accounting situation, yeah, like at first they're completely unknown to you, but they become known to you very quickly. Like I don't understand. I guess for the people, especially with with Brian Hastings, did you follow up on the Brian Hastings situation? Were you reading along with that in NBG and seeing all the interesting comments being said there?
I know briefly what happened, that Brian Hastings was accused of multi-accounting, but I haven't followed it much more closely than that.
Yeah, he sent a message to someone. He's an idiot. So, but I guess even in that situation, I guess if you're a high stakes player and you see a new allegedly fun player show up who's playing like a fun player, aren't you going to be like if you're playing 400, 800 or high stakes, aren't you going to be thinking like, wait a second, maybe this could be someone else on another account? Like, doesn't that sort of cross your mind as a poker player? Wouldn't that cross your mind, Tyler?
Well, I mean, I think the statistics tell the tale in these situations. I mean, your HUD's going to tell you whether the player is semi-competent or not. Mm-hmm. If they're way out of line, if they're playing a Russ Hamilton strategy, then you're going to know that he's probably a fun player, barring something crazy. But if he's playing pretty reasonable statistics, you have to seriously consider that he's a pro in some form, and you've never seen him before.
Right. I think that was always my approach to the situation. If I didn't, if I saw an account that I'm confused about, if I don't know much about it, I'm not going to go ahead and assume it's a longtime fun player unless it's one of like a Scout 326. Is Scout, by the way, is Scout still play Nolima games on Stars?
He does. He's actually down at 400 these days.
Oh.
He's moved down in the world, which is great for me, but probably not so great for the legions of players trying to hunt him at 510 or 2550.
I mean, I think at like 3 or 4 years ago, I thought he was getting the games. He played at 10-20 and 5-10 and 25-50. He didn't really seem like he was that terrible. Obviously, he's not beating a game of 8 professionals and some of those, you know, borderline winning players at the stakes they're playing. But I feel like did he get better since the past? Like, how could he get worse?
I tried to bluff him the other day, and the board was like King-9-2, and there was two spades. I'll try to keep this to a minimum. And the third spade came out on the turn. So it was like King-9-2-3-3 spades. And I like fired three barrels at him and he called me with 9-4. So I'm going to go with probably not.
Maybe he cares less about the money at 2-4. Maybe he plays worse because it is at 2-4. I mean,
he might. I've always gotten the impression he just doesn't. I mean, obviously this is an important part of his life. He's just here to have some fun.
I can't believe he's been having fun for 76 years now. he's been having fun for so long. I mean, you think he'd get a new hobby by now, right? I mean,
everyone's got their own hobbies.
What are your hobbies, Tyler? What else do you do besides play poker?
NBA? I play poker. That's what I do. I don't know if I actually have other hobbies. I mean, I like games of all forms. I like playing chess.
You like playing chess.
Yeah, I'm really kind of establishing myself as family man Forrester here. I like reading. I like running. I don't drink a lot. I don't think my name will be PLP anytime soon.
Have you ever been PLP?
No.
Okay. It's not a bad thing. Don't worry.
I'm really just your pretty normal nerd.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, when we have a lot of these guys on, we have like the Benini Sixes and I mean, I consider you one of the better players in the games for quite a long time. So when you have some of these guys on, you never quite know, you know, what their personality is, whether they're the quiet. I don't want to throw any normal derogatory terms. Some people throw out some of the guests I had on, but you know, you never really know. It seems like a lot of these guys aren't, you wouldn't classify them as like the everyman. I feel like with you, you're almost like the guy at my my uncle Tyler, like, you know, you just have a family and you just happen to be fucking awesome at poker and be able to crush for and have good work ethic and be focused and have discipline and be strong-willed. I mean, you know, but besides that, you're like sort of like the everyman.
Well, thanks, Joe. That's super nice of you.
The way you live your life standpoint, that's sort of accurate, I feel like.
Yeah, probably. I'm pretty conservative. I mean, I guess you can see that in why I've played Midstakes for so long as opposed to moving up to the high-stakes games.
That makes sense. I guess with more free time, are you feel like you're going to want to – because this is how I was. When I was 28, 29, I realized I didn't have any hobbies either. Although when you're single, you notice it more because you start having conversations with women or you have conversations with people and they're like, what do you like to do? And you're like, well, I play poker. And they're like, what else do you do? I'm like, well, I play poker. I play 24 tables at one time. Like, I'm a poker player. And then you quickly realize that you have nothing to talk about with people sometimes. And that was what sort of inspired me to like, maybe I should get some hobbies or I'd find some other new things I enjoy. Do you feel like without poker in your life, that might be something that comes to you and you decide to pursue yourself?
Yes. I like my life. I like doing what I'm doing. I suspect I'll keep doing it. I like solving problems, and poker was always one of those things where I could spend my time learning more and more about poker and how to play it, how to do it better, and I could spend my time thinking about it. And I really enjoyed that aspect of it. I suspect that whatever I do next, if it's computer programming, I'll spend the same amount of time figuring out how to do it better. Because really, to be a great poker player, you can't take a lot of time off. It needs to be an obsession of some form.
1,000% agree with you. I think that's one of the biggest things is just being consistent, consistently playing, consistently thinking about your game, working on your game. Yeah, I think that's I think that's a pretty accurate way I would say.
I mean, after 10 years of this, I mean, every couple of years we're learning something more about the game. If I was playing the strategy I played in 2005, oh my God, they would be chasing me around. I would be the fun player.
Do you feel like people chase you around now, or I guess are you pretty well respected? What's like the amongst the regulars in the stakes? What do you think they would say about you or think about you?
I mean, I guess they'd probably say that he's a winning player. I don't know if they'd have a lot of thoughts about me at this point in time. The way those games are situated at this point in time, scripting has become such a big thing. I'm not sure people think about each other as much as they have in the past. Yeah, I mean, I'd have to be fairly well-respected. I've known it for a long time. And I'm sure the chat's now blowing up with other derogatory comments, but that's okay.
Listen, Tyler, this is what I've gone with this, and I'm really taking a stand on this. If you like the chats where they're calling people names and they're saying all the fucking Twitch comments where they're trolling people, you got 100 million of those chat rooms out there in the world. This is a place for positivity. This is a place for some support. If you got something wrong and you need some support from some people and you don't know anyone else, you come to the fucking chat in here. We're going to pump you up. We're going to try to help you make you feel good. This isn't a place for all that shit like that. So if someone does say something like that, they're going to get Kim Jong Joey. We're going to ban them. We're going to take them out of here. And this is something I've been with this in the past, but I'm very much going to live this out because, you know, did you ever watch any of these Twitch streams, Tyler? You ever see these chat rooms? What happens in a lot of these things?
They can get a little bit negative.
Right. And even if you look at 2+2, very negative place for the most part. There are some sub forums where it's still relatively positive, but I mean, dude, NVG, all these people, even a lot of people I talk to in Vegas. I mean, and I guess I have a little bit more successful poker friends than maybe most people do. Those people tend to stay pretty positive, but a lot of people I met out in Vegas, very negative. They're fuck, man. You know, it really you know, gave me a kick in the ass. And like, is this really the industry that I mean, yeah, it's just really made me think a lot.
I think it's been a tough year for folks. Volume's down like 13 or 14% on the websites. Mm-hmm. I think that's really hurt people's win rates, and it's made people a little bit more negative than they have been in the past.
Yeah, I think it's pretty easy to be positive when you're winning. It's very hard to be positive when you're not winning, or if you're on a downswing, or if you're not career peaking, or if you're, you know, having some adversity and uncertainty in your life that you need to deal with.
Yeah, for sure.
No. Have you had any sort of adversity in your life you've had to deal with, I guess, in the past 4 or 5 years?
No, not to speak of.
I've been cool. I've been okay. I've been chilling here, having no adversity in my life, you know, winning money, GTO, 5248, getting married, having a good time, traveling around the world. It's all good, Gogol, man. It's fine. You like the outlier, son. You're that 1% they talk about in the books, man.
I really doubt it. I'm just a guy who shows up to work.
Oh my God. There was this guy called J Rock Half who played he plays full ring, $50 cent dollar 1/2.
Yeah, huge winner, right? He's been playing for years and he made a lot of money doing it.
Friend of mine, had him on the podcast. Known J Rock for a long time. And I was always like, what's this motherfucker doing playing 50 cent? I mean, not quite in those terms, but kind of in those terms. Because I was like, what is he doing playing 50 cent dollar? This is 2008. What is he doing playing 50 cent dollar? And now he's still playing 50 cent dollar. But you know what? He's pretty well established in a lot of his life. And I feel like a lot of people who maybe didn't play 50 cent dollar, who were like, you know, trying to take the path to success, whatever, the glory, you know, they might not be well situated right now.
Well, I think it's what you make of it. I mean, those high stakes games are always really high variance things.
Yeah.
You only got a couple hundred thousand hands a year at them, and I mean, in a couple hundred thousand hands, anything can happen.
That's true. Anything can happen. Anything. I guess you never felt that, like, you never saw them, and you're like, I have $200,000 in my account. I'm gonna, I mean, maybe allegedly you have $2,000. We don't know if that's true or not, but. You're like, I'm going to play 10, 20, 25, 50. Like, you never really got the inkling. You were just, how did you stay in the zone where you're just like, I'm just going to keep doing that?
Well, I usually cash it out to buy a rental property. So I never had that much liquid. Because if I had that, I'd be buying property with it. And that's a pretty illiquid investment. If you can't really just call up the bank and get more money off of it tomorrow to go play in a high-stakes cash game. I mean, I've played some high-stakes cash. I didn't like the swings in it. I was never that comfortable losing that much money in a night. Because, you know, you run bad at 25-50, lose 50 grand pretty easy.
Mm.
It doesn't mean anything. It literally just meant that you had a bad night. So it was something I avoided.
Well, that makes sense.
I played a lot more 5-10 than I did 10-20 and 25-50, and I did pretty well at that.
Yeah, so with you doing well at 5-10, wouldn't that sort of mean that you're probably going to do – like, did you ever want to test yourself against the debatably best in the world at the higher stakes?
Not particularly. I mean, I was playing poker to – I mean, I like winning. I like making money. It seemed kind of foolish to play people who are better than I was for ego. I just never saw the point in it.
How do you know they're better than you, though?
I could study what they were doing and try to figure out how they played better. I just assume they were. I assume that was intellectually. You've got what, 300,000 people playing poker regularly. The chances of me being in the top 10.
This is the kind of shit I'm in for. Let's go. Break this down, son. Let's hear it. Go ahead.
Okay. So let's say we have 10,000 professional players, and they all work roughly hard, because every professional I've ever seen works really freaking hard playing poker. There's not a lazy poker player. That's not something that really exists in the world. And so we've got 10,000 of these folks. And if I'm going to play 25-50, I probably need to be in the top 10, roughly, at No Limit Hold'em. I mean, that's the guys who really crush and make the money. Everyone else is kind of in there, you know, trying to find a weaker fun player and make it happen. And so that's like a 1 in 1,000 chance that I'm the best poker player, you know, a good enough poker player to beat 25-50. And that just didn't seem like a good odds to me. I mean, I was, you know, I was pretty comfortable in the fact that I was probably an okay poker player. Maybe I was in the top 500, but that didn't mean I was in the top 10. So playing 25-50 for large sums of cash didn't make a lot of sense to me. It didn't seem like a very good bet to make.
But what about 10-20 too? Because you said you played a lot of 5-10, not much 10-20.
I played 100,000 hands at 10-20. And it turned out,
kid, that's like a month or two for you, man. That ain't a lot of hands. Come on.
Right. No, not a lot of hands. I never liked keeping enough money online to play 10-20. Was probably the other side of this. I'm trying to think back and figure out what my rationale was at the time. It's been a long time since I've even thought about playing that high. I didn't keep $100,000 online. I was always a little bit scared of the UIGA thing. Mm-hmm. Where I, you know, where they shut down the account and I lose everything. So I cashed out pretty regularly. So that was one of the reasons. And then the second reason was, in all honesty, I didn't run very well at 10-20. I think I ran something like 50 buy-ins below expectation over that 100K hands.
Okay.
And this was in the days before they had those sort of statistics. So I had no idea what was going on. I just knew my win rate was a third at 10-20 of what it was at 5-10.
Do you believe in the notion that if you play higher stakes against better players, you're going to get better yourself faster, therefore potentially increasing your win rate at those stakes that you might have struggled at first, and then?
No, I don't.
No, are you serious? You really don't believe that?
Okay, well, I can get statistics on any of these high stakes players. I can watch them play. I can see what they do. That doesn't necessarily make me a better player.
Wow. So you don't think you being in those situations and playing against, so let's take for Haley, for example, which... So let's say you're playing against Four Haley. You don't think playing against Four Haley and just seeing what he does in real time in different situations and being able to put that into your own memory bank and think about how to apply it to something you might be doing, you think?
No, your assumptions, okay. I have to disagree with you here a little bit, Joey.
That's fine. I want you to.
I can watch the high stakes games and see what Four Haley's doing without having to play him. I don't need to actually be in the game to watch someone play poker.
Hmm.
To think about how they play their strategies. I can dial it up while I'm watching television and watch him play his hands. The other thing is a lot of it's statistical at this point in time, and a lot of it's player modeling. And some of the player modeling things I'll never be as good as Four Haley is at.
So can you describe player modeling for people out there in the audience who are like, what the fuck is player modeling? Like, what is this guy talking about? Player modeling? I'm playing on Bovada. I don't have to player model anything on here, man.
Okay. Well, a lot of your money comes from understanding how your opponents play better than how you play. So you need to end up with some sort of model to figure out how this player plays. I think Phil Hellmuth used the eagle, the lion, the mouse, and the baboon in his penultimate book that no one should ever read about how to play No Limit Hold'em. So, I mean, that's the basic idea, is you classify the player into some sort of category, and then you take a strategy that max exploits that player's tendencies.
And I guess the trick for you is to figure out which strategy that might be.
Yeah, and so you have to figure out what strategy it might be, and then you have to figure out what player category this player might fall into. And it's something that somebody like Ben Solsky does really well, Four Haley does really well. I always found myself slightly mediocre at it. I was better at designing bigger strategies that were solid against lots of different player types, as opposed to, you know, really great strategies against individual players.
If a recreational player watched this podcast and heard the way you talk about poker, what do you think they would say?
That I was a gigantic nerd.
What do you think they'd say about? No, I mean, you weren't. What's your hat say?
It's a fishing company.
What nerd wears a fishing hat? What nerd goes fishing?
I'm from Montana.
Yeah, exactly. That's what people from what do people from Montana do? Fishing, football, sex. Is that pretty much accurate?
Hunting. You forgot the hunting.
Oh, hunting. Okay, hunting. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
We're outdoorsmen out here. I mean, I think the average recreational player, if they like games, would get, you know, enjoy it. I don't know if they'd get as much of a kick out of the gambling aspects listening to me talk about it than some of the other players. But, I mean, there's a lot of really interesting strategic things to be done in poker.
Why did you never play PLO? I think you would have really liked PLO. I mean, just from the way – it's a problem solving. When it comes to problem solving, PLO, there's so many – unique situations you can break down. I mean, oh my god, it's like a fucking endless, like a button versus big blind situation where you're debating what to do as the big blind defender when you're defending. I mean, it's just, it's like literally endless. There's endless things you can run in poker. Like, it's just, you'd love it. I mean, you really would.
Okay, so I played a couple hundred thousand hands of PLO.
Got the PLO.
I have a basic sense of how to play PLO. Mm-hmm. What it turned out was, is my win rate was so much lower playing PLO than No Limit. I couldn't
obviously
change.
How, okay, when you first start out playing PLO, how is it possibly going to be as high as your No Limit Hold'em win rate, though?
Of course it isn't, but at the same time, it was so much lower. I was pretty happy with my No Limit win rate. I didn't see the need to jump games and take more risk. Try to improve, you know, to try to boost that hourly. I guess the bottom line was I was really comfortable playing No Limit, and I was making enough money that it didn't make a lot of sense in my mind to switch. Maybe that was wrong, but that was the way I was thinking about it.
I think that's the thing. When people always ask me, like, do you think I should switch from No Limit to PLO? My question is, are you one of the better players? Are you one of the bigger winners? With you, I feel like you've been one of the bigger winners at your stakes in your games for a long time. Like, why would you switch? Like, why not just keep doing that, right? Why take the variance around the high variance where you're you know, you're used to this, which I imagine your graph. What does your graph look if you had to model it with your hand? How can you just like spell it out for us?
I mean, it's about like that.
Okay. It's like the old PTR graphs on straight up
for a while.
So it was like, what was it? It was up, E, and then back up again.
Yeah, that's most of the graph. I did lose 10 grand. I usually lose 10 grand about once a year. So, usually.
You usually lose 10 grand once a year.
About, yeah.
Hassan, okay, we got to give a couple shout-outs to the chat, by the way. I got to give a shout-out to Flo from Cologne. Flo came and picked me up today. I'm in Germany. We went and played some basketball. He's out of shape. Obviously, you know you know what happens if you're a viewer. You come play me in basketball. I take it to you. And I gave him that work. Shout-out to Flo, though. Very nice man from Germany. And who else we got here? I got to give a couple. I usually give some shout outs here, Poppy. I got to show some love. VPIP Pro, what's up, Poppy? Matt L, what's up, Matt? Matt, you're a couple minutes behind, but it's all good. It's okay. Ryan O says, Bovada play. can't even mention that. I'm gonna get too many comments in from Twitter from people saying don't mention fucking blah blah. Don't say that. I'm not gonna say it. All right, fine. Hassan, what's up, Hassan? Poppy, what's up? Two Live Miriam says, you got a better cam, ? Shit looks pretty good. The webcam quality, just too bad ain't no thick chicks though. Two Live Miriam, I'm sorry, there's no thick chicks behind me right now. I apologize. It's just me and Tyler hanging out here. Two men. I'm sorry. I apologize. Tim F, what's up, Poppy? Jerome, what's up, Jerome? Sarah Toby Hidozen says, you're doing great work for Run It Once. Thank you. That must be for you.
Thanks. Thank you.
I love the way you say that, by the way. Say that again.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to try it. Hold on. Let me find a question. Let me find a person. Hans, what's up? Hans, puppy. Thank you for joining the live stream today. What's up, Matt? He says, love the Leatherass ghetto streams. Leatherass opens up a Microsoft Word document asking people to send him money. He does not. Leatherass is not begging for money on Twitch, is he? Can someone confirm this, please? He's such a disrespect. Whatever. Do you like Leatherass? It sounds like you might not have the most positive things to potentially say about him.
Me? No, I don't dislike Leatherass. It's just his style of play, which was built around the idea of finding the weakest player and playing him. Has been copied so many times now, it's not a viable way to make money playing poker at this point in time, at least on Pokerstars. You really have to grind against the regs to make any sort of cash.
So you would associate, I guess, it seems kind of sad to be associated with your name's associated with the biggest bum hunter of all time. I mean, I'm pretty sure
he like wrote a book about it, didn't he? I thought he was always very open about what he was doing and very honest and told everyone how he did it and had a coaching contract, had books written. I thought he always kind of, I mean, he obviously felt some pride in what he was up to.
I don't know. He did write a book. I believe that it was a couple years ago, guys. I read the book, and I'm not gonna shout out the book because I'm not gonna be able to do it. But it was an okay book, I believe, in retrospect. It's an okay book.
Good. I've never read it.
Okay. You're right. No, you don't need to read it. It's an okay on the spectrum of like 1 to 100, and when it comes to books, it was okay. It was, you know, in the 30-ish percentile sort of range.
30-ish percentile? Ouch.
It's okay. Have you read any books? Have you read any of the 2+2 books? Is there any like material that you felt like you really liked or you really enjoyed?
I guess there's 3 books that I've read recently that have been really influential in my game. The Mathematics of Poker by Will Chen and Ackerman. That was a huge book. It made me a lot of money. I can't say enough about it. And then Will Clifton's last 2 books have been really keen. They're really smart books, and they're well-written, and they have a lot of really pertinent information about how to play No Limit.
Well, who is the person you just said?
Will Tipton.
What are his
books? I think they're about heads up, sit and goes, but they end up covering a lot of really pertinent concepts to No Limit Hold.
Interesting. Got to check these books out. Put them on my Google list here. The Mathematics of Poker, that's by William Chen?
Yeah, Jared Ackerman.
That's a pretty popular book when it comes to, I guess, what's the other math book? There's one other math book, right? That's always.
Juwanda's, I think, is the one that people talk about.
Okay, I think it's Mathematics of Poker. I think, I'm not gonna say that. But I think, let me just Google this book. I just want to make sure I have the Mathematics. You said you just read this book recently?
No, I reread it pretty frequently. It's something that I take a lot of information from. It's a lot of toy games, so there's not a lot of direct application into No Limit Hold'em, so I go back and reread it and see what I can learn a little bit more and apply a little bit more out of it.
Okay.
It was really the first book that kind of introduced the idea of a number line for poker hand, for your range. You know, you actually play it based on the percentile hand you have in your range. And that was one of the key, you know, this was one of the key points in No Limit Hold'em, because before that, people would just try to read each other's hands. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, that's a whole different technique than this current GTO-ness that's become so prevalent. And most of the GTO ideas are based on this idea of a number line. What percentile hand you should, you know, take what action with. And so they have pages and pages of these.
This book was out in 2006.
Yeah, I read it in 2007, thankfully.
Jeez. And you feel like it's still, I read, there's a book there, you know, I guess the PLO books that I feel like I've read a couple PLO books like 15 times. And I just like read them for fun. Like I go back and read them just to brush up on things and sort of, you never know what you might forget. I guess this book is probably pretty advanced to the point where you almost are reminded of something, you could potentially learn something new or have something new to think about each time you read it.
Yeah, quite often. Most of it's algebra. There's not really directly applicable hand advice. It's not telling you how you should play aces in middle position. It's talking about how you should design a range in middle position to play. And that's a far more complicated topic and something that I can still learn something about after 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Just looking to see who makes this book. Oh, Conjico. I didn't know if 2 plus 2 made the book. I guess not.
Oh, I thought they did for some reason. I thought they had Sklansky on the cover.
I thought 2 plus 2. That's because I was just at the – shout out to 2 plus 2, by the way. I was just at their headquarters in Vegas. They showed me their book. Holy fuck. They've got like this like warehouse of books, all the 2 plus 2 books. I didn't know they put out so many books. They're like – I went in there, and I'm looking around. I'm like, holy shit, you guys wrote a lot of books. And they showed me like a breakdown of everything. It was cool. Like they have a PLO book I took home, and I read the PLO book a couple times, and it's probably like – I mean, it's a great book to just learn more about PLO. A lot of people always ask me, like, what's a good PLO book? And I'm like, I kind of know one, but I'm not going to mention that book. But now I read this, and I'm like, oh, this book's pretty good. So, but yeah, they have a lot of the.
I'd be interested in reading it.
The PLO book?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's just a basic pot learning Palo in Omaha book that they have out. Let me get the.
Does it do hand advice or is it more sophisticated? No. I don't know. I always kind of lean away against the books that suggest limping jacks and PLO and middle position and things like that. I never really feel like they contributed much to the.
Yeah, I gotta be. I think there was one book. What was the guy? I think was it Jeff Huang that wrote a book, and it was sort of geared towards live PLO. I feel like. And I believe there was something like that in there where you should limp Jackson. And if you ever see someone who says you should limp Jackson anything in PLO, you probably should close the book, guys, and not read the book because there's.
It seemed like they had some structural flaws with it. I've read the book. I tried to apply it. It didn't go as well as I would have liked. I said, okay, I'll limp Jackson or middle position.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that anymore. Let me find out this book real quick because I do want to. At least looks like a very normal book. I think it was just called, Potlove in Omaha: Understanding Winning Play. Was the basics of the book. So, I mean,
awesome. Well, I'll take a look at that. Yeah. Added to my extensive collection of poker books.
What else do you read? Do you read anything else non-poker related?
Yeah, I read quite a bit. I read The Economist most weeks. I'm starting Game of Thrones again for the second or third time. Third time, actually. I get a massive kick out of reading R.R. Martin, George R.R. Martin's books. Mm-hmm. You probably know the HBO show.
Of course. Well, you know, it's funny. I actually have never watched the show, and a lot of people seem to be jealous of that fact, but I'm waiting until Game of Thrones is done. I have this thing where whenever I watch TV shows, I like to watch till it's completely finished, and then I'll go back and catch up and then sort of figure out what I missed, and that's usually my approach on TV shows.
Yeah, that makes good sense. I read a lot of behavioral economics books, a lot of psych books. Those are quasi-poker related. I get a kick about how people learn how they react to things. How people view the world. And a lot of that stuff eventually ties into poker because so much of what you do is playing against people and how they, you know, how they think about the world.
Mm-hmm. Would you have a shout? You want to shout out one or two books? There's a lot of people out there love reading. I love reading. And a lot of times we get recommendations from guests and people read the books. They usually end up liking the books because they're usually awesome books. So give like one or two of your favorite books. And if people are interested in checking those out.
Oh, man, that's on the spot. The Game of Thrones books are awesome. Freakonomics was really good by Levitt, Joshua Levitt. There's a couple of irrationality books by Dan Ariely that are really cool. And then there was actually a Nobel Prize winner, Daniel Kahneman, who wrote Thinking Fast and Slow. And that book has actually a lot of really pertinent things to poker and just life in general. It really describes about how different psych quirks that you wouldn't think people would have. It's Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman.
When you read books, how are you? Because I feel like when I'm reading books, there's so much information being thrown at me. I mean, they have a book right here just about social media, and it's 160 pages. And like, I'm learning sort of new things and, you know, 130 pages. So how are you, how do you like taking the information? How are you note taking? Like, what's your process when it comes to reading a new book or even a poker book?
I curl up with it and I read it and then I see what sticks. I mean, if it's something that's really interesting to me and something that's complicated, especially like the math books, like Mathematics of Poker, I'll end up having to get it out of a piece of paper and actually work through the equations to understand them. But if it's a book written for people to read, usually, I just read the book and I learn something from it. I try to remember parts of it. If it's super interesting, I'll read it again. Try to learn more about what's going on. I've always been really, I've just been really gifted with a great memory. So it's not very hard for me to read something and remember it.
Do you ever take an Adderall? You had the Vyvanse, any of the ADHD drugs? Have you taken those before?
No, I haven't.
You don't drink a lot, right?
No.
Pretty clear-minded most of the time, it sounds like.
Yeah, I mean, if you're playing poker for a living, you kind of have to be. Considering basically my edge is my mental ability compared to someone else's in most of these situations.
Do you have any thoughts about the idea of taking Adderall or Vyvanse, or these ADHD drugs, to play poker?
I've heard really good things about them, that people are really successful taking them. They're essentially academic steroids. I don't even know where I'd get them, in all honesty. I'm pretty clean cut.
Do you want me to tell you where you get them from? It's really easy and it's legal.
I go to the doctor and I claim I have some sort of attention deficit disorder.
Pretty much, yeah. I asked you that because I've stopped taking those things. And I never took them for a long time. I tried them. The first time I ever tried them, I played a 33-hour PLO session where I definitely played the most hands ever played. And in a day, I believe, at that time, I also lost a lot of buy-ins. And I was like, what is this drug? Because you hear so much about Adderall. Now it's in the esports Adderall. The Dota players are taking Adderall for a competitive edge. And you're like, and I was always like, what is this Adderall about? And then I tried Adderall and I took Adderall and Vyvanse for about a year and a half. And, I decided, I was like, I have to stop taking it because you do become dependent on it to some extent. And it can't be good to be dependent. It's like, do you drink coffee?
Sometimes. Wouldn't classify myself as dependent on it, but I do drink coffee.
Yeah, it just seems like it can't be good to be dependent on a stimulant to like go upon your day and have success at what you're doing. You know what I mean? What do you think about that?
No, I think that makes good sense. I mean, most of the time I think folks take it because they're up against a wall. They got to finish a project and they have X number of hours to do it. And, they need to pass the course. Well, they're taking these things. I don't know how many people are. That'd be really interesting. I don't know very much about it. It's not something I've really looked into.
Honestly, in retrospect, it's something I wish I didn't look into. And, I was playing a live PLO out in Vegas, and I was talking with a guy named Matt Gianetti. I think he final tabled a World Series main event. He played in the PLO games the regular. And we started talking. I had like a couple of pills for my prescription left. And I was thinking about, I was like, I need to get off this. I can't, I just have to stop. I feel like it's changing the person I am. And I talked with him and he was like, get off of it now. Like if you can, because he's been off it for months. And yeah, it was one of the best. I love live poker, by the way. Do you play live? Just changing the subject. Do you play live poker?
I do. I usually play about once a year, 10, 20, or 25.
You don't play you play once a year live poker?
Yeah. I usually end up in Vegas about once a year, and I play the 10, 20 game at the Bellagio.
I love live poker. Like I pretty much play it at a bunch of sessions at Aria. Shout out to Aria, by the way. They got PLO. Got some things they need to work out. But I played some PLO. I played a lot of a little bit of No Limit too, and I just love live poker. Like there's it's. Do you think about maybe doing some more of that in the future now that you're going to be in the United States? Although Montana probably isn't a hotbed for underground private cash games and casino regulated games.
Not so much. We have a $300 pot limit. You can put up to $300 in the pot, and then it's capped.
Which creates really interesting. Sims, you've been in the lab breaking down some GTO approaches in that game, or what?
Yeah, super interesting playing Omaha. You know, with like 2-5 blinds, someone raises to 20 at a 9-handed table, and then you basically it's cap pre-flop. So all 9 players see the turn and river the flop with $300 in the pot, and they chop it up.
Well, from a theory standpoint, it sounds like that's a beatable game if people are putting in $300 with this wide spectrum of hands.
Yeah, you should just be able to fold until you have aces probably or something. I don't know. The percentages are probably pretty close 9-handed. I'm not even sure. Would you use Odds Oracle? How do you model 9-handed Omaha hands?
Well, I mean, it's definitely – it's one of those toy games. It basically, it's like – I mean, it's more of a poker juice sort of thing, I guess. So for those that have – for anyone that's watched this podcast and has watched a lot of my podcasts, you're going to notice a distinct change in what I'm allowing in conversation, what the conversation's going. And one of my favorite things to use is poker juice, which I've never said that word before on the podcast until this point in time. But, no, that's the appeal. Do you use that at all yourself?
I've seen it. I haven't used it. It looked really cool, though. I saw the demos of it.
It's definitely really fucking cool. You love it. I mean, it's yeah. You love it. What do you do? Can you say what you use to do your breakdowns, your equations, whatever you'd call them?
Yeah, sure. I mean, obviously, if you watch my Run It Once videos, you know that these are tools I use pretty commonly. I use I actually use an equity calculator quite a bit. Like Poker Stove is surprisingly valuable. And then Card Runner's EV is something that I use quite a bit. And Pio Solver is a recent addition to my repertoire. Mm-hmm. And I'm not quite sure as how to use it as well. If you aren't familiar with Pio Solver, it's a software that solves for the GTO solution given two ranges and a flop and some bet sizes. So if you give it a flop of bet sizes and two ranges, it'll solve the GTO solution for the situation. And it turns out that this actually ends up just massively complicated. I think they end up with something like 40,000 different turns and rivers with different strategies. So it's really been really interesting trying to learn how to use it just because it's so much information that how do you reduce it into something that a human could use? Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm gonna have to check this out. I never heard of this one before.
Yeah, it's worth a check out. It's interesting. I think that's going to be one of the more interesting things in No Limit over the next couple of years is really the transition to this pretty heavily base computer modeling, at least in the higher stakes games.
That's pretty cool. Party Poker Party? You know, are you familiar with the very legendary online player Poker Party? Who played on Pokerstars and the PLO games for a little bit of time?
I am not familiar. Could you tell me about this fellow?
This guy was a motherfucking legend. He would play like 65-hour PLO sessions, play 10 guys heads up. He'd have these epic upswings. I met him one time in when I was in Vegas, and he's like a very much a legend in the PLO world, but he's been disappeared for quite a long time, but I feel like he might be in the chat right now. I think that actually is the person I'm thinking it is in the chat right now. So I'm pretty excited right now.
Pretty exciting.
Definitely exciting. Completely missed what resource they're talking about. Luckily this gets uploaded on to YouTube. You can rewind it later on and go.
IO Solver.
Oh, Pio Solver. Don't reward them like that. Come on.
They're Joey. I mean, they're your fans. You got to help them out.
Do you have a lot of fans in your Run It Once videos? I feel like you probably do.
I think you have more fans than I do, Joey.
That's definitely not the question. I've been
green eyes, honestly. I can't compete.
What?
Your beautiful green eyes. I can't compete.
Oh, my. Hold on a second. Is that true? Look at them.
Are they actually green? They look green on my on my camera.
Yeah, I feel like they're like a mixture of green and blue. Whenever people look at them, they always like, oh, is your eyes green or your eyes are blue? It's like a sort of a mixture in between there. You know?
Mixed.
I didn't know I had green. All right, man. I'm speechless, kid. I'm speechless. I don't know what to say anymore, you know? I'm speechless. So, did you go to the World Series this year?
No, didn't go to the World Series this year. The last time I was there was in 2006, I think.
Jesus Christ. You like money, right?
Yeah.
You understand what these live games are, right?
Yeah, but if you look at the variance calculations on them, they aren't amazing.
Oh, my, the variance calculations. Hey, Tyler, when we're done, send me over the variance calculations, please. I'd like to take a look at them for myself. Do you know my friend Lafort, Sean Lafort? Have you seen his podcast before with him?
I have not seen Sean Lafort's podcast. I saw a couple of his Runitonce videos. He's pretty keen.
Smart. You'd love talking to him about all this shit right here. I can't quite like get into it the way he can, but man, he is all about this type of everything. He actually taught me something about heads up PLO that I was like, holy shit, okay. And then I've been applying it, and it crushes, obviously, because you know it's very. I'm not telling them what it is, but
yeah, I can't give out my secrets. I'll be a professional poker player very long.
Why did you decide to start making Runitonce videos? Speaking about giving out secrets.
I knew that it was time for me to move on once I got married, that the amount of time I was going to be a professional poker player was going to be fairly limited. And so it made sense to raise my profile in the community. Mm-hmm. Because when I went back to school the first time, I didn't really have anyone to show anything to, because being the best poker player in a lot of ways is being the quietest poker player. You don't want to tell people what you're doing, you know. Most of your edge comes from people not understanding why you make certain actions. And so going out and explaining this to the populace isn't exactly the best way to make a ton of money, which was, you know, how I operated. But as moving into the more mainstream world, I needed better credentials, because a person sitting in an office understands a coaching video, but they might not understand what the money graph is, especially money being such kind of an odd – it's such an odd thing in the real world. People don't like talking about it. It's not something you can really brag about. And for a poker player, that's really the only currency you're operating in. You know, how much money did I win in this game? How many big blinds did I win? And those metrics don't translate very well into the mainstream. Whereas something like a coaching video translates a lot better, because you can show, you know, X number of people like this video. You know, these are the things I've contributed. This is the person I worked for. This is the work I put in for them. So those things really encouraged me to make poker videos, as opposed to, you know, being a silent killer in poker.
So you're telling me you're doing this podcast for the job?
A little bit. I like talking to you, Joe. You were super flattering. You came on my Facebook and you're like, hey, I'd love to talk to you. I find you so interesting. I've Googled you. It's hard to turn down that sort of flattery. Not going
to
lie.
Let me tell people what I said to you, okay? Because that wasn't what I said. I said, Tyler, what's up? You're my favorite videos on Runitonce. You're a person, one of the people I want to just talk with and have on the podcast the most. Do you want to come on? That's what I said.
That's super flattering, Joey. I was like, sure, I got to do this. So I dialed up a couple of your podcasts and I watched them. I liked what you were doing. I wasn't sure if I could be as cool as your other guests, but I really appreciated getting the chance to talk to you.
I mean, I don't think it's like about being cool or being this or being that. I think it's like a way to people that get to know the poker players, like get to know more about them, get to know, become a fan of them potentially. I think with you doing Runitonce videos, obviously I feel like you're open to that. And it sounds like from talking with you now, like that's, you know, now people might watch this and then they watch your videos on Runitonce and they become, now you have more numbers to show the future job. Oh, I can't believe you're getting a job, man. That's crazy. I can't believe you're getting you really want to get a job.
I'm not sure yet, but I'm going to keep my options open.
That seems crazy. How can you go from 10 hour? Well, I guess you've looked at poker as a job. So you, like you said, repeatedly, I show up to work, I put my hours in, I put my time in, and then I was done. I guess you've sort of approached poker as a job, like our boy Leatherass advocates, for a long time.
Yeah, I've viewed it for a job for a very long time. It was, I mean, it was a lot of risk taking on poker as opposed to other opportunities for me coming out of college, and I wanted to make sure that I maximized them. So I've been approaching poker like a job for the last 9 or 10 years, and it's not going to be that much of a transition into the real world to do those sort of things.
I can't believe you're getting one. I'm sorry. I just can't believe you want to get a job, man. That's great. It seems crazy.
At the end of the day, I mean, I want to be close to my family. I want to be back home. And that doesn't leave a lot of poker opportunities for me being in Montana. There's some coaching applications. I can coach people. I can, I can make videos for Runitonce. But at the end of the day, eventually my life leads me away from poker. As much as I've enjoyed doing it for the past 10 years, I can't do it the same way that I've been doing it. Eventually, Suzanne and I are going to want to have a family, and traveling every 6 months with a small child is basically impossible. So it makes sense that I'm going to end up somewhere in the real world.
I'm not getting married. This is what I learned from today's podcast with you, Tyler. I appreciate you. Sorry, anyone in Germany, I'm not going to marry you. I apologize. Although, I don't know. I'm going to get into something different. I'm going to get into the idea. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. The idea of, if you're going to have a child, you should have it with somebody foreign and try to pick a good country that mixes well with the country you're from, therefore to get the most GTO child.
So you want a bilingual child or a trilingual child?
Lingua, that means they know another language?
Yeah, they know two languages or three languages.
In a perfect world, I'd like to have my child be half American. Shout out to America, by the way, land of the free. And a quarter Norwegian and a quarter Korean or something like that, or Asian. Because you
so
get
the dating websites for this?
Well, that's the problem. Now we're talking. There's an issue with this. I don't think there's a dating. I mean, you could go to Norway. You could go to Norway and sort of put in a session and try to find the mixture, but I feel like it's sort of challenging. So
yeah, I feel like you've got a business opportunity, Joey.
What do you mean?
This is be a great website. You get the ethnicity of your children.
Maybe we match you up, like you tell us what ethnicity you'd ideally like to mate with, and then we try to match you up and find that for you.
Yeah, you could have a selection of half Norwegian, half Korean women that you're matched with on this dating site. Call it meetforeigners.com or something.
Wait a second. Meet, okay, hold on a second. Meetforeigners.com. Okay. I'm going to think about this more, Tyler. And someone made up a good question in the chat. They said, Joey's just trying to create the super GTO poker kid. What countries do you think create the most GTO poker mind, in your opinion?
GTO poker mind? Well, I think you'd have to include a Russian at this point in time because they're at the top of the game.
Yep.
Maybe a Swede because they're really, really aggressive.
Okay.
And then I'm going to have to go with Dubai or something just because you need so much money that you're just like – just doesn't matter.
Okay, you know how terrible people from Dubai are at poker, though, right?
But you've got the Swede and the Russian to balance it out.
What about you need the Asian for work ethic, though?
You might need the Asian for work ethic. I don't know which – I mean, you've got a lot of ethnicities there to choose from. Maybe like Vietnam.
Vietnam. Okay, so what about America? I feel like America's got to be in there.
I think so. I feel like the Russians have surpassed us at poker at this point in time. With all the travel the American pros have to have done so recently, most of the really great high-stakes regs are Russian, at least in No Limit.
Are they Belarusian, I believe? Are they Russian? Are they some Eastern European country that you've never been to? And you're like, what is happening in this country?
Better Google it and find it on the map.
All right, so we got Sweden, Asian, Swedish, Russian, Vietnamese. And that's it?
Yeah, I think that would be what would be your idea on this?
It's a great Tyler, it's a great question. Well, obviously they have to be American if I actually want to create this. I'm asking this for
an actual reason. Okay, so it has to be half American.
Half American, a quarter Asian. I'm not sure which Asian ethnicity. I'd have to do some sims. I'd have to get in the lab a little bit and break it down on country grinder, whatever. I don't know the exact site to break this down on yet. The card runner's EV of breakdown in of country. So some sort of Asian country, and then definitely a Scandinavian country. And I sort of like the idea of Middle East in there too. So I gotta think about that more, Tyler. I'm gonna start asking all my guests that question though, because
that is a super interesting question. I've never considered it in such a manner, Joey.
There was this girl on my plane. I took to Tomorrowland. I went to the music festival I mentioned before to you, and she was asking people two questions. She said, "What's your favorite word that starts with the letter P?" That's for you. Now I'm asking you, what's your favorite word that starts with the letter P?
Parrot.
Okay. And then she said, if you could torture anyone in any sort of way, what way would you torture somebody and why?
I'm going to pass on that one.
You've thought about this, haven't you? What kind of shit are you watching, Tyler? Come on, man.
I never really considered this one. Chinese water torture.
What does that mean? Where they tie you? What is that? What does Chinese water torture entail?
I think this is where you get a drip of water on your forehead.
Oh, constantly?
Yeah, constantly. It eventually does all sorts of crazy things.
Okay, I've never thought about this one. I'm trying to get the lighting situation now. This sun.
Right, so what's yours?
What's my okay? So obviously, I've asked this question before to people, and it's actually one of my DTO questions to ask random women. And how would I torture someone? It's got to be interesting. So here's what I've come up with. You put them in a very dark room that has some sort of really bright light on you at some point in time, over periods of time. You play very loud music, a loud song, and the song is, "Who let the dogs out? Who, 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 who?" And it's just that part the entire time for 24 hours a day, basically. And I haven't gotten much farther than that yet, but it's something like it revolves around that idea, and it's sort of like it's a working theory right now for me. What do you think?
That sounds like some fraternity pledging that has happened in the past.
Oh, so you're saying my idea is shit?
No, I'm not saying that. Maybe you want a bottle of whiskey involved in it.
Now we're talking. That's actually, I got to think about this more. Now that you brought up my idea, yeah, man, wow, okay. I didn't think about that. You're kind of, yeah, it is like a fraternity sort of pledging thing. Let me look at my sheet here, kid. Let me see what else I got in here. I haven't had to use the sheet much because I only knew two things about you, and that's that you went to Duke, you used poker refugees, and you've been playing poker for a long time, so. Let's see.
I know you're such a great conversationalist. We managed to talk about this now for an hour and a half off those three facts. So I got to give you props.
Well, that's in my Twitter bio. It says I'm a conversationalist, but I'm also a self-appointed conversationalist. So I appreciate you using that term to describe me.
Yeah, no problem. You'll have to add it to your Facebook page.
I don't know. We'll see about that. All right, so you say you travel a lot. Where's your favorite place you travel to, and where is the place you'd like to travel to eventually?
Where would I like to travel to eventually? I really like Costa Rica. I had a great time on the beach in Costa Rica. A beautiful country, just super great vacation spot. I enjoyed my 6 months on the beach in Hako. Where else has been cool? You know, I really haven't went to a lot of bad places that I wouldn't want to go again. Every place is interesting, even Rosarito, even though you're joking about the kidnapping, it's still really beautiful. There's waves, there's beaches, there's sand, there's lots of interesting Mexican culture.
What was the name of this place? I'm sorry, I didn't understand what you said.
Rosarito, Mexico.
Rosarito?
Yeah, Mexico.
I know Rosarita, I don't know Rosarito.
Are you trolling me? Nice.
Wait, what was the name of the place again?
Rosarita.
I don't know. What are you talking
about? Now you have to Google this. What is it?
I know Rosarita.
I can't. Okay. Rosarita.
Okay. All right. Wait. You ever heard of a drink? It's got tequila in it, sweet and sour, and sometimes salt. And sometimes some margarita mix. You ever had one of those?
I have not, but it sounds delicious.
You've never had a motherfucking margarita?
I have had a margarita. I just have never made a margarita.
It's called a margarita, by the way. So let me just make sure. Let me correct you on the pronunciation of things. I've been learning German. I'm trying to figure out words that are similar to, like, quesadilla, bonita, hola, como vamos, papi. Like, I'm trying to figure out my equivalent German phrase. And I think I've got it. It's, wie geht's dir, papi? Even though papi is technically Spanish, it's not German. But I've been studying German. Do you know any other languages? Do you know Spanish at all?
I know a little bit of Russian, actually. I don't know very much Spanish.
Wait a second. Now it's all coming clear now, guys. 10 years he's been playing the games, winning at a decent win rate. Knows Russian. How do you know Russian, Tyler?
I actually studied abroad there in college.
Wait a second. Hold.
I went to St. Petersburg for 3 months while I was at Duke.
Oh, let me sit down on the couch here, Tyler. Wait a second. So you're saying allegedly you spend time in Russia and you know Russian?
I would not classify myself as knowing Russian, but I know some Russian.
Okay, so did you meet any programmers while you were in Russia that you might keep in touch with now?
I have not met any Russian programmers thus far, though who knows? It's amazing how big of a network of poker players there are in the world.
Do you keep in touch with any Russians still that might play poker on PokerStars?
I coach a couple of Russians, but no one who plays high-stakes poker on PokerStars.
Is Four Haley one of your good friends?
Four Haley is not one of my good friends, but he seems like a very nice guy.
Are you friends with a man named True Teller?
I don't know True Teller, but True Teller fascinates me because his strategy is so different from what everyone else has come up with. And he seems to just kill with it, so I'm always fascinated to watch him play.
What
should be your next guest, Joey? Get True Teller on.
You know, I saw him in Vegas a couple times. Most people I went up and talked to, and I was like, hey, like, most of them knew who I was to some extent, but I didn't go up to talk to him. I wasn't sure if you know who I was, so I decided, I was like, I'm not going to say anything to him.
Well, do it. Find a way, because I'd be super interested to hear him talk about why he plays the way he plays.
Well, what would you say about the way he plays? What's different from the way he plays compared to somebody like For Haley or Hollywood Ike Haxton or something like that?
Well, I think the interesting things, before Harley grew up playing six max, so he moved up the stakes playing six max. So lots of his strategies resemble roughly what I would play in games. There's not a lot of difference. We learn the same way. True Teller grew up playing cap games, and it really changed the way his preflop game looks, and a lot of his bet sizings and things just seem really interesting to me. They're much different than a six max full stack player would play. So it's always fun to watch him play because he comes up with interesting methods of playing that I never really would have thought of that are obviously really effective because, I mean, he's absolutely crushing his games.
Is there something specific you can think of off the top of your head that you might
I think the biggest thing was is some of his preflop ranges, how he'd choose to play like 20 big blind cap, where he would be jamming like 7-6 suited over some raises and things. I don't play a lot of, you know, short stack heads-up games, so I'm not really familiar with the ranges. But watching him play those games and then watching him play some of the deeper stack games, he'd use similar methods in the deeper stack games. I found that really interesting because it wasn't something I'd do in my own personal game. And then a lot of his bet sizings, especially the smaller bet sizes, weren't something I think people were considering at the time he was doing them. So I thought that was really interesting. That was a new nuance to the game. Because a lot of us six max players kind of stuck to pretty standard bet sizing in lots of spots.
Yeah. I've noticed watching your videos, you do some weird shit with bet sizes, man. You kind of adopted a similar approach to some situations.
Yeah, I mean, it turns out that bet sizing is really important. The different bet sizes gain you a lot of value. So using them effectively is a really important part of No Limit Hold'em. That said, doing it poorly doesn't gain you a lot of value. So really it's knowing how to do it right that makes the money.
Well, I guess that's sort of the trick. That's one of the challenges and tricks to poker is you got to figure out you know, you got to figure out how to do that.
You do. I think it's one of the biggest challenges remaining in poker is really figuring out the bet sizes and the frequencies and spots. I think at this point in time, most people know how to play pretty basic, solid poker. Mm-hmm. But actually understanding what frequencies you should choose with different actions and what bet sizes you should take with them is still stuff that people are going to be learning a lot about and stuff that people over time will still, I mean, there are going to be challenges years from now. There's no way that this is close to being solved, at least in those situations.
I feel like we're going to look back at this time period and no matter what, 3 years from now, we're going to say, God, games were soft back in 2015 in August. You know, they're going to, either way, no matter what happens, we're always going to look back and sort of have that viewpoint on things. Even if now we're like, they're so hard. Oh my God. You know, yada, yada, yada. Like, it's still going to,
I wish I'd had the chance to play more in 2013. Those games were so soft.
That's what everyone else
says. I say that all the time about any period of time that's passed.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Somebody asked me what happened to my knee. So I have a. So I was in Dusseldorf in Germany, and I saw some kids. I was walking with a friend. And I saw some kids jumping up and down, warming up. I was like, "Oh, what are these guys doing here?" And so I went up and asked them. I was like, "What are you guys doing?" They're like, "We're gonna do parkour." You know what parkour is, Tyler?
Yeah, I do. I've seen some awesome videos. So you did parkour?
Well, let me get into it. So they're warming up. I'm like, all right. You know, I'm you know, whatever. I'm athletic. I play ball. Let me warm up for some parkour. So I'm warming up. I'm doing the things, and they're doing some things up the wall. And where the fuck did they just climb up that wall? So I decide that I'm gonna go do some parkour with them. And at some point in time, I try jumping over a wall. I end up like. You know, I don't know, remember what happened, but I hit the wall, hit the knee with my knee. I go tumbling over. There's a car. I nail my head into the car, the side of the car. I'm just like fucking up on the ground. I'm like, what just happened? Like, I feel like I haven't felt like a sort of a feeling like this in quite a long time. And I got up. I was taken back to health and. I went back and laid down, took some Advil, drank some whiskey, and felt a lot better. And that's my experience with parkour. Do you have any experiences of yourself with parkour?
I tried a rope swing in Costa Rica over the water. You swing the rope over the water. I did not make it to the water. It hurt like hell.
Wait, what?
Okay, so you have a rope swing where you jump into the water, right? And you're like swinging it. You swing out over and you jump into a pool.
Yeah, you make it.
People do this, right?
Right, you make it into the water, though.
I didn't make it into the water. I held it too low, and I just smashed into the rocks, and that was the last time I tried parkour.
Well, I don't think that's called parkouring. I think that's called rope swinging into the ocean from the Costa Rican coast.
Missing the ocean from the rope swing.
You sound like you're just as terrible at rope swinging as I am at parkour. So it sounds like we got a little bit in common here.
I think we do have a little in common. I think you're slightly more athletic than I am.
The thing is about parkour, like, what's the worst that could happen on that rope swing for you? Hypothetically. I mean,
I could get dumped on my head and die, right? It'd be unlikely, but that's probably the worst.
Great point. What are you, 52%? You 52-48? Like a negligible difference in the number?
Yeah, that's kind of how I feel. It's usually a coin flip whether I'm going to live or die on a rope swing.
What do you think the riskiest thing you've ever done is? Where your greatest percentage of death doing that thing was?
The greatest percentage of death?
Correct. Whether it's 0.01%. Like there's something you did at one point in time that held the greatest percentage of death in that spot.
Oh, probably. It had to be drinking in college with like the 40 shots in 20 minutes. I don't think it was actually that many, but it was some absurd number of shots in a very short amount of time. That had to be the highest chance of death.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Of course, like,
it does sound pretty deadly when you think about it from a GTO standpoint, my friend.
How about you? What's the most deadly thing you've done?
Well, it definitely involves drugs, 100%, and it's got to be ecstasy in like Australia or something like that. I feel like there was probably a couple points in time I might have taken a little bit too much, and although I don't really know, I've never really, you know, when you think about MDMA. Do you know much about MDMA, how kids use it or how people use it at these music festivals or for clubbing and stuff like that?
I mean, I heard it's amazing that it pops your serotonin receptors and just makes you feel just incredible. That's about all I know about it.
Yeah, I feel like I don't really hear too many people that overdose and die. Typically, I think what happens is people might mix it the wrong way or they might take some bad shit that's cut weird. But you don't hear too much people. It's not like cocaine where you feel like you hear people overdose on actual cocaine. So I don't actually know how close to death I could have been with some of those times that I had. What else? Yeah, it's got to be something involving that, man. Yeah. I've never really drank too much. I don't think I've ever really been drunk, maybe once or twice or three times in my life where I'd be like wasted sort of situation like that. So you sound like you did a lot of that in college, though.
I did it a couple of times.
What kind of person were you in college? Were you like the big party animal who was smart and sort of, I don't know. I don't even know what college people are like. Honestly, I didn't really go to college. So.
I don't know. I mean, I think that everyone tries drinking in college. I definitely imbibed too much at several points in time over the course of my college career.
Yeah. You didn't know your current wife. You met her in high school. Did you talk to her throughout college? Or where did she go to school at?
I didn't talk to her in college. We actually went to separate colleges. I ran into her back when I moved back to Dillon after I graduated.
Dillon, Montana.
Yes, Dillon, Montana. That's probably the most times you've ever said that word.
How many people live in Dillon, Montana?
About 3,000.
What?
3,000.
3,000 people live in your town?
Yes.
You own a house in this town that 3,000 people live in?
Yes.
What's that like? What do you like?
Pretty chill. The main differences are is you don't have a Walmart and you don't have a Barnes and Nobles and you don't have a Costco. But you end up with grocery stores. You know all the people around you,
mm-hmm.
which is nice. There's lots of outdoorsy things to do because it's a fairly sparsely populated area. Mm-hmm. I guess the county is about the size of Connecticut and Rhode Island combined. Wow. There's only about 10,000 folks.
Jeez, that's so – is there like a McDonald's, Burger King, stuff like that there?
Yeah, there's a McDonald's in town. It came in 1999 maybe.
Hmm.
We don't have a Burger King, but there's some good local, family restaurants. It's big enough that there are restaurants, and there's a college in town, so it's not
– there's a college in your town?
Yeah.
What college is in your town?
The University of Montana Western.
Yo, shout out to them, by the way. They're playing. They're doing something right.
The Bulldogs.
Harry says, I'm driving through Dillon. I don't think Harry's driving through Dillon. What should I do? Any bales of hay? I think he's just trolling. Never mind. Let me make it back.
Yeah, it sounds like he's trolling me.
Okay, we actually have a story. I'm going to read the story.
All right.
Hassan says, I rog-dogged a Cambodian hooker after doing some speed we bought from a taxi driver. Most dangerous thing I've ever done. Jesus.
That sounds super dangerous.
Yeah, really. yeah, he says, when I was freaking out and when I got tested as soon as I got back to the United States, the entire office heard me ask the doctor in a panic on the phone, okay, so do I have AIDS or not? Well, damn, okay.
Well, I'm glad Hassan survived.
I mean,
maybe he did. They have good AIDS educations these days.
Yeah, I feel like with, I used to. I used to be worried about AIDS, but when I found out about the medication that they had, it's like, yeah, why would you worry about it? Why would you stress? Although, to be fair, Tyler, have you ever gone into the doctor for a test?
I have.
Was it a sweat for you? Were you sweating it?
No, I've been really thankful. I haven't had any sweaty tests. But I could definitely see how it would be a major league sweat on something like AIDS. I just imagining myself there would be terrible.
Yeah, like
– sweat would be almost as bad as the actual act of getting it, I think.
I don't know. Would you know you got it, though? I feel like you wouldn't know you got it.
Until they call you, but you'd have that whole period of time.
Well, I think they tell you. No, that takes a couple weeks, doesn't it? No, I think they. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know either. Maybe Hassan probably knows.
Hassan, what is the AIDS protocol? Does it take a couple of weeks? Like, what? How does that work out for you? Get back to me, Hassan. Get back to me. Let me go. Joey, that's the college you should play ball for. Yeah, if you're still living in Montana, I kind of want to go back to college and play basketball. Is it like a D3 school?
NIAI. So.
Oh, is that worse than D3?
Yeah. It's pretty equivalent. I think you'd have a good shot.
I'm not trying to play the Super Bust, though, Stakes. I want to at least compete.
It's competitive. There's teams. They have a league. There's 8 schools in the league.
They play basketball. There's a team.
They play basketball, yeah.
Okay. I'm learning a lot here. Let me go back up to a couple.
You chip in a chair, you'd have a chance. I mean, you could still be an NBA player. At least you're out hustling.
No. I've realized that I've lowered my expectations from NBA. I'd like to just play Okay, Rohano Tavidin says, "Oh wow, puppy! Seen close to all your podcasts with poker players. Second time seen a podcast live. So stoked! Keep up the good work. Much love, puppy. Much love, much love." Dries De Becker, hey puppy, what's up? What's up, buddy? Matt L says, "I've watched every Gogol's video." Do you intend on making a lot of videos in the future, puppy?
Yes. I've got a contract with Runitonce through March, and I guess we'll figure out from there what's going on. So
I feel like they're going to want you back. I think you do some pretty high-quality work there. So why wouldn't they want you back? Maybe now you can get a raise, though.
Maybe I can. Maybe I'll keep working on the raise angle of it. Everyone write in and tell them how valuable my videos are. Thanks, guys.
Okay. Harry says, "I wasn't trolling, I swear. But anyway, good luck, Joe and Tyler. Keep the good work on the podcast. It was nice meeting you that one time in Vegas. I live here now. If you ever want to grub or kick it, poker party, much love, Harry." I'll hit you up, Harry. I think we're still friends on Facebook. Next time I'm in Vegas for a bender or just a life living adventure, I'll hit you up and we'll get after it, son. Thanks for tuning in live. Thanks for commenting, questions, all that stuff like that. Guys in the chat, if you guys have any questions for Tyler, now's the time. Go ahead, give them to me. Ask away. Anything you want to know. It could be anything, honestly. Anything you want. Fire away at him, man. He's an open book. Are you an open book?
Am I? I'm a poker player. How open could I be?
That's true. You got it. What's your biggest secret?
The biggest secret?
What's your biggest secret that you can tell me right now?
I can tell your 8,000 followers.
Shots at my followers. Hey, kid, we're at 10,800 subscribers on YouTube right now, man. We're making
That's huge, Joey.
We making moves out here, son. We making moves, man. We coming up.
Well, I understand why. I mean, you're such a great conversationalist.
Gracias, papi. Thank you, as you would say. Thank you. Okay, what's one of your biggest secrets you can tell me about?
Biggest secrets? Oh God. That's a hard question. What's one of your biggest secrets? Let's hear an example here.
Come on, motherfucker. Why you say you put me on the spot like that? Huh? I got to think about this. I've never actually
You just put me on the spot. What are you?
It's a pot. The guest is Tyler Forrester. I'm supposed to put you on the spot. That's the job.
I need an example, though. I have to get bailed out by the host here because I'm not very good with secrets.
Let me think about this some more. I'll think about it some more. Do you have a power rankings list for mid-stakes players on Pokerstars?
Power rankings list? I mean, King Ten of Clubs has to be huge. He's been playing now for years. He's made a ton of money doing it.
Legend. Very, very legendary American player.
Analog Lotka is currently just absolutely crushing. He's just unbelievably. It's like four. He's won like 4 times as much money this year as anyone else at 3-6. So I have to give a shout out to him. Caliban has been huge now for a long time. Makes really good money. Tetis One. Now I'm getting into all these Russian names that are just terrible. He's a huge winner. Really crushes it. Nagoyu 2005 and the Zoom games are unbelievably sick. Player. Average Greg.
Average Greg, really? He's one of the – you put him in the power rankings list.
Yeah, I would. He's, you know, nice. Really large win rate. My name is Carl, I think. And there's one other. I just forgot her name.
Gemstone?
What?
Tim Stone, is that the name you'd put in the top rankings list for six max players? Tim Stone, you ever heard of him?
No, I would not put Tim Stone in the list. Why would anyone put Tim Stone in the list? Except maybe Tim Stone. Maybe Tim Stone would put him in the list.
Why would anybody put Tim Stone in that list? Shots at Tim Stone. Oh my god. Okay, go ahead. What would be the who might be the other one?
My name is Carl. They're all huge. Who else am I thinking of? Stamboloff is quite good. I think I've covered the most of them. Yeah, I'm trying to think who else I should give a shout out to.
What about AJ Phoenix?
I haven't played AJ Phoenix in a year. What's his screen name on Stars?
AJ Phoenix, I believe.
Is that actually his screen name on Stars? I haven't played him in years. I don't.
I think so. I think that's his screen name on Stars. Yeah.
Okay. He was a great poster in the small stakes and alpha.
A great poster. He's a great poster. Would you put him in the top rankings list? He's a great poster on the small stakes forums.
I haven't played him in years. I can't even remember the last time I played him.
He's a great poster. Come on, man. That's my guy. That's my guy, AJ, man. That's my guy. Learning Japanese, man. He's, it's whatever.
I enjoy reading this stuff.
Do you watch any Twitch streams? Are you ever intending to stream on Twitch yourself, potentially?
I've watched a couple of Twitch streams, and it seems borderline suicidal from a professional standpoint. Just because you really do get minute-by-minute footage of how this person's playing and how he sees the game.
Right.
So it seems like you'd have to balance that against the number of Twitch subscribers that you got. I don't see it being – I mean, I think somebody like Nanoko does it really well because he's got such a large following that it probably offsets some of the issues with Twitch streaming. But for me, I mean, I'm a run-it-once coach. This is more people than have ever heard me talk in my entire life. So I'm not really going to draw a lot of people on Twitch.
I would disagree, but I think, if you're like extremely good at the game, you're going to draw a lot of people. Like people want to see someone who's extremely, extremely good at the game, right?
Yeah, for sure. I think it's super interesting though. I like watching them. I really get a kick out of watching people stream on Twitch.
Who's your favorite Twitch streamers?
Ah, shoot, on the spot. I like Nanoko's ones. I was watching, NKTD. He was playing my Midstakes games. I really enjoyed watching him stream on Twitch. I don't know if it's caught up to the same point yet, at least in the Midstakes games. Jason Somerville seems to do an awesome stream for Sit and Goes. Mm-hmm. I think we're still seeing it develop with the cash game players. I think it's probably an easier pitch in the Sit and Goes where your head's up against different players. You're less really worried about showing it off.
I think, as you said, it seems almost suicidal. It's a great fucking way to put it. It seems almost suicidal to stream yourself in real time playing above 1-2 it seems crazy. Like if you're another regular in those games, you can watch those games. Like watch the person play. It just seems really. It can't be. I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, I guess you get enough Twitch subscribers that it offsets the loss and win rate. That's what I think what you're looking at is the options. I think it's much easier selling Sit and Goes or something where you're playing one player at a time and a lot of the strategy is standardized anyhow, so you're not going to see a lot of big deviations between different players.
Yeah. Let me find some... Let me find some more questions. Has any PLO players started streamed on Twitch? TJ, what's up, TJ, man? Yo, shout out to TJ. TJ, what have you been up to, man? Are you still playing PLO? What have you been doing, man, with yourself, Poppy? Let me see. Let me go back up. Poppy, is the Korean chick still there? Shout out to the stalkers. Calm down, stalkers. Calm the fuck down. Tyler, do you post in the heads up no limit regular thread on 2+2? If not, why it needs you?
I could start posting there. I don't know what I'd say. I'm not much of a heads up no limit player, but thank you for the for having such a high opinion of my advice.
I love modest, Poppy. You're very modest. Do you post on 2+2 at all?
I did for a long time under the handle MT Blue, but they had a hacking scandal several years ago, and I lost the handle because it was attached to a dead email address.
Are you interested in getting the handle back?
I would be if I could. Do you happen to know how? I had a couple thousand posts under it. I kind of liked it.
Well, I feel like I could. I'll put you in touch with someone. And
all right, that'd be awesome, Joey. Thank you.
Put down real quick. Hold on a second. Yeah, I'll get it back for you. Hey, yeah, I'm gonna have Nano Noko on a podcast pretty soon, by the way, just because it sounds like you like him. So we're gonna get him officially on a podcast, even though I feel like we know a lot about Nano. I mean, Nano's a family guy to himself, so, but it'll still be interesting to have him on and hear him talk. So
I'll definitely be tuned into that one. I'm always interested in what he has to say.
Yeah, I'm pretty. Damn, TJ said, "Been taking care of my family. Sickness has sadly fallen upon them." Damn, that sucks. That is not good, Puppy. TJ, I hope they get better soon, my friend. I think TJ is a what nationality are you, TJ? I believe in American culture, it isn't really if your family gets sick, usually isn't like people put them in some type of home or some type of place. Like it usually, I feel like in foreign cultures, it's much more GTO to like stay with them and take care of them and try to get them back.
I think that's what I'd do with my family. I wouldn't put them in a home.
Yeah. I don't know. I haven't heard about this situation happening too often with some of my friends or with people I know. I feel like with my parents, they put my grandmother in a retirement home sort of thing. But I feel like a retirement home might be different than if your family got sick. That might be a different situation altogether. So. Yeah,
I think there is a little difference between an old person's home and a kid got sick. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be sending my kid off to the institution. Maybe if it was like the 1930s.
Right, a kid. I guess maybe it's a – I'm going to talk to TJ more. TJ says Danish. Yeah, TJ, keep me updated, man. Hope things go well with you, Poppy.
Yeah, I hope the family gets better.
Let's see what else we got in here. Joel says, "What's up, Poppy?" What's up, buddy? Liam says, "Who are Tyler's friends in the game?"
For a long time, no one.
Really?
I didn't have a single friend who played poker. I had one friend from college who's now, he's a PhD in biology, so he does biological things. We used to be buddies, but no, I was just, I mean, I never really wanted to share my strategy with anyone. I always thought it was super detrimental to my career, so I was super secretive about how I played poker and what I did. And it's a little tough to become friends with regs in your games because you have to see them every day. You have to play them. Joey's obviously done a heck of a lot better job with that than I could, but it always freaked me out when I knew what I knew. So I've been talking to poker with someone, how they were going to play against me. I just ended up with a giant mind trip.
Yeah, I think I used to think that's a similar type of way, like, oh, I don't want to talk strategy, yada, yada. But over time,
you're such a gregarious guy. I mean, obviously, like, you're going to get out and meet some people.
Yeah. Either way, though, I feel like for a long time, it wasn't necessarily that way. Until I started doing the podcast, though. That's sort of when it started. So, I don't know. The podcast is a great idea. It's 2 hours. No one's fucking watching anymore. We can say anything we want right now. If you're watching 2 hours in, shout out to you, by the way. Much love. You tuned in to me and Tyler talking for 2 hours, talking that talk, man. Much love out to you. Shout out to you, by the way. I'm going to be back on, guys. I'm going to be back probably Wednesday. Get this, Tyler. I'm having I have this girl, Kate Hall, on. She's been one of these people on Twitter who's a female poker player. I think she went to Duke as well, actually.
Oh, cool. There's a lot of other play poker.
Yeah, I think she went to Duke and like Yale or some shit like that. Like some like pretty serious.
Wow, that's some serious academic resume.
Yeah, for law. Like it's pretty legit. And there's this big sexism in poker debate going on 2+2 and on Twitter. There's all these debates. It's just, I honestly, when I read this stuff, I don't know what the fuck the debate is. Like, Are some women treated weirdly by men at the poker table? Well, obviously, yes.
Yeah.
Are some guys treated weird at the poker table? Yeah. Like, there's some weird people that play live poker. It just happens. And I just want to know more about it. I want to learn more because I don't know. I just don't know what the hell they're talking about. So,
yeah, that'd be super interested to hear your perspective on it. You obviously will have a very articulate opinion of
right.
What happened.
And
why you decided to do it.
I'm a little bit worried that it might almost be, you know, too sort of, you know, it might not be like a conversation. It might just be like a scolding or a teaching or like a, you know, it's where I'm just getting pounded. Like, this is the exact way things are. This is how it is. This is how it works. And like, you know, I don't know necessarily like those conversations the most. I like it better when it's a give and take and, you know, like, yeah, it's a.
Oh, I'm sure she'll be super chill. She can't be the tiger mother.
Yeah, I told her not to yell at me in Twitter when I talked to her. I was like, please don't yell at me if I have you on. And she's like, oh, I was just mad that one day on Twitter. Like, I'm not going to yell at you. I'm like, okay, fine. Please don't yell at me. So yeah, we'll see. If you had to
recommend. All right, I'm definitely tuning in now to see if Joey gets yelled at.
Yeah, I might. I'm going to talk about the BGG, the big girl grind, and see what she says. Because, yeah. Do you know about the big girl grind, or is that the kind of thing?
Oh, can tell me about it, Joey.
The big girl grind is BGG, big girl grind, 160 or above. Me, Tyler, we show you love. 160 or below, gotta go. You ain't a big girl. You gotta take off. You gotta get out of here.
That's a little arbitrary.
What the fuck, man? Are we really breaking? Are we really approaching this from a GTO standpoint? 52-48, huh?
Yeah.
Are you a big girl grinder, Tyler? What kind of girls are you into?
I'd have to be a big girl grinder. I guess I'm a BGG.
Yes. You in the BGG, huh? What are you into the real lady grind?
The real lady? I guess I'd prefer women as opposed
she
to
a real lady if she ain't 280.
Yes. Yes, it's below 280 for sure.
Oh well, I mean,
that's quite the size girl right there.
It's a real real lady. No, we love the big girls around here, man. A lot of people out there, they're very derogatory towards big girls. I love big girls, man. I like big. I'm into the big girls, man. I'm not saying I'm not into the Asian girls or the Korean girls or the Japanese girls.
We've established that you want a half Norwegian, half Korean chick.
No, we're in the lab. We went back to the lab after you brought up some new information to me about my potential super child. Oh.
Okay, so what's the new?
Well, Russian's got to be involved now, and I don't even know where the fuck we're gonna meet an Asian, Russian, Norwegian kid. So I gotta get in the. I don't even know if those type of people exist.
They have to.
Somewhere.
I mean, there's 6 billion of us.
What do you think how would you find someone who's a, like, okay, hypothetically, you're in my situation. You're not married anymore, okay? Are you married?
I am married, yes.
You're not married. Married?
But I'm not married now. All right, got it.
Okay, hypothetically, you're not married right now, okay? You're me. You're in Germany. You have this idea of the super GTO child, Russian, some type of Asian descent, and Swedish. Where do you turn to first? Google? Like, what do you go to? Do you think Sweden's going to be the best option to find? Like, what would you do?
Okay, Cupid. Right?
Yeah, but
there has to be some way to search by this.
Maybe, you know, those, you ever heard of those places in Thailand where all the prostitutes are, and there's always talking about Russian prostitutes. Maybe you can find one that's has some Swedish descent who's also mixed with Asian.
I mean, you should be able to. I think that you probably start talking to your Russian friends because St. Petersburg probably has some girl wandering around who's part Asian, part Swedish, and part Russian.
You know, Tyler, if only I knew someone who knew a little bit of Russian, get me in the door.
Yeah, you wouldn't want my Russian to get you in the door.
You just, what do you just know, derogatory Russian words?
No, I know like basic sentences, but not very many of them. It wasn't one of the highlights of my academic career.
All right, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put on my bucket list, find a Russian, Asian, Swedish woman. I mean, honestly, how can a possibly that combination not be attractive? Like, I don't, yeah.
I think you're probably all right as long as she's under 280. That's pretty good.
Why are you sending shots at the real ladies for, man? Yo, we got a lot of real ladies that watch out there, man. Shout out to them. If you're a real lady, you need some love, come fucking hang out with me and I'll show you some love. I'll give you a little bit of love. Google Estonia, south of Sweden, rest of Russia. Interesting.
Ooh, Estonia. Estonia might be a good call. You'll at least get like the Swedish Russian. Then you just need someone who's transplanted there from middle Russia. Mm-hmm. I think I just created that term, but I mean, most of Russia is in Asia. There's lots of Asianic features.
Yeah. Tyler, your homework for today is, over the next year, just get in the lab a little bit, maybe break down some sims on potential country matches on where to find the women. I'll share my work with you, obviously, too. And maybe we can come to some sort of plan here to better approach. Maybe there's more countries that are, maybe we should think about how countries mix together when it comes to our Super GTO child. Because, like, obviously, like, sure, we can be like, we want a Mexican, Brazilian, Russian, Asian person mixed with me. Like, yeah, that's going to be hard to fucking find, dude. So maybe we can start putting the likelihood of selection into our probability calculations and then work harder at figuring out what the GTO mix would be.
I think that'd be an excellent idea. We'll have to get out a pen and paper and really... really hammer this thing out.
Maybe I can get in touch with the creators of Poker Juice and ask them if they can put some sort of spin-off of
it. Some sort of dating algorithm based on nationality.
I don't even think it's a dating algorithm. It's just we want to find them. We want to locate.
You want to find them? Well, Craigslist.
Dude,
anything on Craigslist.
Searching for this mixture of woman. All right, I'm going to get in the lab a little bit. Peter.
I mean, that's probably better than most of those Craigslist posts. Just saying.
How much time are you spending on Craigslist, Poppy?
Not very much. But have you ever read a Craigslist post?
You know, Tyler, tell me more. What kind of posts are on Craigslist?
All sorts of things. Thousands and thousands of items. Mm-hmm. Apparently you can find anything on Earth on Craigslist.
Mm-hmm. Are you telling me? I'm not going to get into it anymore. Okay, so Peter Anderson, who's the one who he asked me on Twitter, he said, when are you going to have Tyler Forrester on? I was like, that's a great question. And that's when I messaged you right after that. So it was he asked the question. He says, do you think you have better mental game than your opponents on the same level?
Do I think I have better mental game than my opponents on the same level?
Correct.
Maybe. I'll have to think about this. I mean, as a mental game, is the idea of understanding why I do what I do and being able to do it even if I'm angry? Yes. Tilt doesn't change my game that often. That being said, I've definitely broken mice. I'm not exactly peaches to be around while I'm playing poker. But at the same time, I mean, tilt doesn't necessarily affect the way you play. If you know what you're doing, you know what you're doing is right.
Mm-hmm.
You can be both angry and still playing well. I think that's probably the biggest challenge as a poker player is how to keep your emotions in check while you're playing.
Would you keep your emotions in check if you picked up your glass of whiskey and there was a bee in there?
Jesus. That's I'm glad you didn't sting yourself. Ouch.
Jesus fucking Christ, dude. There's like a bee in there.
So if I was drinking whiskey, I got stung by a bee, and I was playing poker, and I lost a big pot, I'd probably lose my bananas.
I would too, man. Now I'm... Fuck, man.
That sucks.
Poor whiskey. Just gets ruined like that.
It's still all good. Just get paper towel.
How bad do I run? How bad? Man, when will it end? If only I didn't have this other bottle of whiskey right here to like take down, man, I might be sad right now, but I think we'll be fine. Tyler, anything else to add?
I'm worried about you.
Do you have anything else you'd like to suggest? You have two podcast guests potentially you'd like to see on in the future for me that I could actually potentially get on the podcast?
He could actually get on the podcast. I really like Nanoko. I'd love to hear King Ten of Clubs talk about what he does, what he's done. He's certainly, I think he's about as low profile as I am on it. So I'd be really interested to hear him talk about how he plays poker and why he does it.
Well, I asked him a long time ago because I met him before. Did I actually meet him in person? Maybe we just chatted a bunch while we were both in Vancouver. But I like the kid. But he said that time he wasn't interested. So I'll ask him again at some point in time. But yeah, he'd be obviously great to have on. I feel like he's a pretty, quiet. He's a quiet kid. So, who knows how interesting people would find him.
Oh, probably very interesting. He's had more success than I have. It'd be super interesting to listen to. I'd tune in, but I'm a huge nerd, so.
That was a troll question, because what a lot of people on here say is like, oh, they just want the end bosses on. They want Hollywood Hacks, and they want Phil Goff on. But like, I feel like a lot of people are really interesting if you can ask them the right questions or get them to talk about the right things. And even if they're not interesting, I think it's pretty cool to learn about how different successful people at poker think about life or think about poker. And I feel like you can always relate with somebody. Like maybe you might watch a Ben 86 and be like, I relate with Ben 86. Or maybe you watch you on here and they're like, I can relate with you. I think that's cool. And that there's not just one way to be. It's you can be a lot of different ways and still be successful at poker. So.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, Joey, you're doing an amazing job with this, with all these interesting people you've had on. I'm super flattered that you chose me as well. I'm still a little confused why, but it was super awesome of you.
Because I love the fucking videos, man. I watch most of them. I don't even go to sleep during them. It's crazy. Like I when I want to go to sleep, I either put a tournament video on, or I put Alexo's video. Hello, this is Alexo 18 for runitonce.com. Today I'm making a 200 video. I got the king ten, and I don't know what he's fucking saying, and I just turn it off. So, and I turn off and go to sleep. I actually, Alexo was that. Did you know Alexo from the videos on runitonce, right?
Yeah.
He came to our. We had a high stakes PLO gathering in Las Vegas, and Alexa was there. So it was really cool to meet him finally. And I like him. I just can't understand what the fuck he's saying. You know what I mean? Like, I want to understand what he's saying because I feel like I like him. I just don't know what he's saying. So
maybe we should consider subtitling the videos.
Have you watched any of the videos?
Yeah.
You need to subtitle them. You really need to subtitle the videos for sure. How does your runitonce? Oh, that's a good idea, Daniele. How does your runitonce contract look except the money part? You said it expires in March, right?
Yeah, they signed me on a yearly contract to make X number of videos. I think it's 26 videos this year over a year.
How do they come to that number? Is that they offer you that and you negotiate, or is that just that what they
say? It's negotiated. Yeah. They came to me with that number, and it was acceptable to me. Obviously, I get paid per video, so a fair number of videos makes more sense than less videos from a payment standpoint. But yeah, that's negotiated. The time frames are negotiated too. I asked for mine to be put on a yearly contract. Usually, they do a number of video contract, but I preferred to have it over a year. It makes my life easier.
You can nod your head. I'm gonna comment on this. So, would you say per video you get paid more than $1,000 a video? Karina, come on, make a fucking reaction.
I'm passing on this.
What are you talking about? Would you say it's more than $500 a video?
I'm passing. I'm just straight up passing. You're not hearing this.
Jesus Christ. Oh my God. All right. Your Iana Ryan says, what up, Joey Puppy? I'm in Chicago for 2 more weeks. What's the number one thing I must do? You been to Chicago before, Tyler?
I've never. Actually, that's one of the few places I've never been.
Well, you can't play online poker there legally. So, or you can, I suppose, but you can't play on Pokerstars legally from Chicago. So it's not the best spot to go right now for poker, I believe.
No, it isn't. I think I played poker in Gary, Indiana once. I think that was the nearest casino when I was there.
The Majestic Star. That's right. That's right down where I grew up from, baby. Majestic. That's a nice place, baby.
That's some great luck there. I like the Majestic Star.
It's a nice place. Not going to hear too many people say that comment again in life. You better enjoy that while someone says it.
Winning makes everything better.
Yeah. That's true. Daniele said, want to tell him about your original sex site project. Yeah, I do want to tell you about it, but we're going to save that for another time, my friend. Tyler, anything else you'd like to add? Andreas keeps mentioning this to me in the chat. I don't really want to mention it on the podcast. It's a very somber thing. He said Cleric, an ex-mid-stakes no limit grinder. He used to play Full Ring. He committed suicide last week.
Oh, bummer.
Yeah, and he wanted me to say something. I don't really know how to talk about that in the podcast. I feel like I can't give that its the proper discussion I'd like to talk about it with. I'd like to learn more about it.
30-second moment of silence. I'm sorry that got that bad for him.
Yeah, I remember he I feel like this is why I'd like to at least read up on if just to make sure it's the same person who I remember from before, but I'm pretty sure he
He was a big winner at Midstakes. He actually made a couple of videos for Runitonce.
Yes, that is the same person I was thinking of then. Yeah, because I remember we had some discussions on online. He was always unsure about what route to go with life, and you know, did he want to do video? He was definitely had some he seemed pretty stressed out on it, to be honest, at the time I talked with him. And that was a couple of years ago, but I haven't really talked to him since then. But yeah,
apparently couldn't figure it out. Well, that's really too bad. Yeah. Sorry to hear that.
Yeah, me too. I'm gonna have to look. I want to read more about this, so I'm going to look it up more. Online poker life equals no life. Gary, I hate to tell you that online poker life does not equal no life. I'm living proof that it definitely does not mean that. Tyler, as nitty as Tyler might look in his fishing hat over there, Tyler's done some pretty. I feel like he's lived in some cool places. He's had some fun experiences as well. So. Do you think online poker life equals no life?
I'm going to go with a no. I mean, I've been all over the world playing poker. I can't, like, you get so much freedom with it. I think you get to make the life that you want to make out of it. And that's incredible. I mean, most people have some obligation to be at their desk from 8 to 5.
Exactly.
And being a poker player, you get to choose your own hours. You can work any hours you want because the games run 24/7. You can work anywhere in the world to do it. So if you don't have a life and you're playing online poker, it's by your own choice. It's mm-hmm. not because you're a poker player. I mean,
I gotta say, the friends I have certainly do some fucking cool things with their life. And, I mean, even the nittiest people do fun things with themselves when they play online poker professionally, especially once you start getting to mid-stakes and you're making some actual money with yourself.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. I guess I was in Vegas in March. I was in Tokyo in April. I was in London in May. I mean, geez, like, who else gets to do that?
Wait, you didn't tell me you were in Tokyo.
I wasn't pertinent to the conversation. Yeah, I was in Tokyo in April.
Tyler, what do you think about when you see this face?
I'm thinking about Japanese tourists.
Can you make the face for me, please? Hold on. Yes, okay. So when I was at Tomorrowland with my friend, we would go up to people, Japanese people, and watch them dance. And like the move, like they're the worst dancers ever. Like one move was like, it was like a flap, and one move was like a barely moving around. And we had this weird thing where we'd go take pictures with them, and we'd do the face like this. And it really inspired me to go to Tokyo.
I'd do it. It was amazing. It's just so interesting. Japanese culture is so unique. And I think that you'd probably get a kick out of, you know, just the – I mean, some of the seedier things that are done in Tokyo are really interesting. Just – Japanese culture is, it's kind of indescribably weird.
What do you mean?
Well, it's like lots of bright colors, lots of kind of quirky sounds. And that's, you know, that's the entertainment side. And then their business side is really, I mean, it's pretty put together. I know we were on the subway and we watched 1,000 people basically march by in suits with little or no deviation between the blue shirt and then the dark navy suit with the dark tie going to work. They all, you know, completely composed. And then you go into the recreational parts and you've got all these crazy noises and these very bright lights and weird colors. I mean, it's just it's completely unique.
Did you say I'd get a kick out of the seedier things in Tokyo?
Yes.
Bang, bang. Okay. Yeah, I guess maybe, you know. I don't know what I would do in Tokyo. I'm not quite sure how I would, what I would, what. Yeah, I don't know what I would do in Tokyo, Poppy. I don't know. All right. You got anything else to add, Tyler? You want any parting words, any last thoughts, any last comments?
I just thank everyone for tuning in. Thank you, Joey, for having me on. I'm super flattered and very appreciative. I appreciated all the comments and everyone who chimed in today. And thanks for listening to this wonderful podcast.
Yeah, well, I like it. Very nice. Yeah, guys, I'll be back on probably Wednesday, if not Friday, with Matt Salzberg, tournament player, TV writer, producer. Very funny, very entertaining. I'm excited to have him on. Next week, Monday, my girl, Jen Shahade, the world champion chess player. She's coming back on. We've hung out a couple times since our last podcast session. She actually set me up on a chess date with a friend of hers, and we're going to have some very interesting conversation to talk about on our podcast. Lafort's coming back on soon. And yeah, a bunch of people lined up, man. We got a lot of, but I'm glad.
Joey.
What'd you say?
I said I'll be tuning in.
Oh, much love, Tyler. And yeah, if anyone made it this far, shout out to you. Emil said Tyler's been a great guest. Super nice guy. Thank you, buddy. Thank you. Peter says, thank you for joining, and you are the best run at once coach.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you for all the nice compliments.
Thank you, Tyler. TJ says, coming on was great. Much love, TJ. Ben, Matt Campbell, Andreas Fichetti. I'll come on, Joe. Definitely going to have you on. Charlie Lua says, see you, puppy. GG. So sick. So sick. What's his poker star's name? Mixer Excellent. I got to let you figure that one out. Use your detective ability. Use your deductive reasoning. Look around the webpage and see if you can identify what Tyler's poker star screen name is. I'll give you a hint. It's on the page somewhere. That's it, guys.
Google's awesome.
Yeah. Google. All right, guys. Tyler was awesome. Says much love. Joe, waiting for another advice as foam roller one. I'll have it for you soon, Henrik. Tyler started slow with the interview picked up. I agree. All right, guys. See you later. Be back soon. Twitter, Facebook, you want to chat. Much love. That's it. Adios.